The next item of business is Stage 3 proceedings on the Mental Health Scotland Bill and dealing with the amendments members should have. The bill is amended at Stage 2, SP Bill 53A, the Marshalled List, SP Bill 53AML and the groupings, SP Bill 53AG. The division bell will sound and proceedings will be suspended for 5 minutes for the first division of the afternoon, and the period of voting for the division thereafter will be 30 seconds. Following that, I will allow a period of 1 minute for the first division after each debate. Members who wish to speak in the debate on any group of amendments should press the request to speak buttons as soon as possible after I call the group, and members should now refer to the marshalled list of amendments, please. Group 1, use of psychotropic substances, and I call Amendment 24 in the name of Dr. Richard Simpson in a group on its own, and I ask Dr. Simpson to move and speak to Amendment 24, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This amendment follows Amendment 109 at Stage 2, which was tabled by Adam Ingram, and followed concerns being raised with him, myself and Nanette Milne. When the amendment was tabled, NICE had just published guidance reinforcing the remarks made by Adam Ingram and the evidence given to the committee by Autism Rights. Patients who have learning disability, including autism spectrum disorder alone, in the absence of serious additional mental illness, should not be given psychoactive substances as a first-line treatment. And when they are given, it should only be used with caution and should be discontinued after 6 weeks if there is no improvement. Now, I have no doubt that my professional colleagues will pay heed to this guidance, and I should, Deputy Presiding Officer, have said, perhaps at the outset of this entire debate, and I'll only say it once, that I am a Fellow of the Royal College of Psychiatry, so I have an interest in this subject. However, as I say, I have no doubt my professional colleagues will pay heed to this guidance. However, too often there is no recording of medicines for treatment of associated conditions such as epilepsy, and so polypharmacy occurs. We know, again, from evidence to the committee, that numerous admissions to hospitals are associated with iatrogenic causes, that is, caused by the administration of medicine which is inappropriate. Of course, treatment under the Adults with Incapacity Act 2000, Part 5, gives added protection to a patient who has impaired capacity in that the carer or guardian must be consulted and treatment must be agreed with them. But this is not the case with the Mental Health Act. At Stage 2, I expressed particular concerns about patients with dementia who we know are not having their diagnosis recorded in 50% of cases on admissions to acute hospital. And I stress, this is patients who have already got a diagnosis of dementia. And this was according to recent Scottish research published in relation to Scottish hospitals, published in the British Journal of Psychiatry. Too often, patients are treated with psychoactive substances, which can render them confused and more likely to suffer falls. Although this situation in care homes has definitely improved since, I think it was Mary Scanlon who raised this issue first in the first session of Parliament, it does remain a worry. I appreciate that the principles embodied in the Mental Health Act should adequately protect patients, but the reality is that this is still not the case. The Minister in his reply at Stage 2 quoted the Patient Rights Act, and that too is helpful, but not sufficient. I know the Minister also pointed to the valuable work by the Care Inspectorate and the Mental Welfare Commission, both of which are having an effect in care homes and mental health settings. But this is not the case in acute hospitals. Here we have the HIS carrying out elderly inspections of elderly care, and yet in the 950 case records which they've examined since their inspections started, only 50% were assessed for cognitive impairment. I believe the time has come to regulate matters rather than rely on guidance. These regulations, of course, cannot interfere with clinical judgment, but by insisting on proper recording of the decision, for example, no psychoactive substance should be used unless the cognitive status of the patient has been recorded, but also ensure that the NICE guidelines are followed strictly, then I think we are going to continue to have this debate in future parliaments. This amendment will tighten up on this area of practice, which has for too long continued to adversely affect too many. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. Call Jim Hume.
One of the most important factors of any legislation is to take into account those most vulnerable and in need of protection in our society, a duty which this Parliament must continue taking extremely seriously. So I support Dr Richard Simpson's Amendment 24 on psychotropic substances. It provides a layer of protection for those vulnerable to being falsely steered into being provided psychotropic substances without their full consent or acquiesce. While I fully understand the scientific justification for providing treatment through psychotropic substances, I think we must be fully ready to control any potential gaps in legislation that risk extending their use beyond what is only necessary. The safeguard of regulations for prescribing conditions to be satisfied for the groups of people included in Dr Simpson's amendment is a positive step and indeed a fulfilment of Parliament's duty to protect the vulnerable while extending their rights under medical treatments.
Many thanks. Minister.
Thank you very much, President Officer. Can I begin by thanking Dr Simpson for speaking to his amendment? Amendments were lodged on this issue at stage two. These would have applied specific measures around the giving of psychoactive medication. This amendment does not seek to apply specific measures, but to require ministers to make regulations setting out conditions that must be satisfied before a treatment by psychotropic substances may be given. I had a very useful discussion with Adam Ingram, who raised these issues at stage two, and Dr Simpson, and indeed Dr Milne, after stage two. I want to thank them for taking the time to speak with me and for their work on this issue. It turns to some of the specific issues that have been raised. Can I turn to the issue of the use of psychotropic substances for those with dementia raised by Dr Simpson, and I think it's relevant to the point that Jim Hume makes in terms of rightly being the case that we should always do what we can to protect the most vulnerable. I understand there are particular concerns about the issue of prescribing of psychotropic drugs in care homes. Safeguards and actions are already in place on that issue, including publication of revised polypharmacy guidance by the Scottish Government in March 2015, which reinforces the principles in the appropriate review and reduction of the use of antipsychotics in people with dementia. It identifies three groups which practitioners should prioritise for review: people in care homes, those with vascular dementia, and those with dementia who have a history of cardiovascular disease, cerebral vascular disease, or other vascular risk factors. And we are taking more action this year to further reduce the inappropriate prescribing of antipsychotics for dementia, focusing on three areas: initiation, review and legality. A proposal has been approved by the National Dementia Group and is now being aligned with the aforementioned new polypharmacy guidance. Moreover, as I set out in the Stage 2 committee session, I believe that the 2003 Act already provides strong safeguards. This includes the requirements of medical practitioners to have regard to the principles set out in Section 1 of the 2003 Act, including patient participation and minimum restriction to any advance statement a patient makes. And indeed, Richard Simpson himself said he has no reason to doubt that professionals are working to those standards. And in relation to medication-specific safeguards, the Commission must be informed in writing after emergency use for emergency detention certificates, and there is a requirement for a second opinion medication consent for those in long-term orders. However, I understand the strongly held concerns which have been raised by some individuals and organisations on this issue, and I believe it would be appropriate for it to be covered in the review that I have set out we will undertake on the inclusion of learning disability and autism under the 2003 Act. I do not, however, believe that it would be appropriate to pre-empt the outcome of that review by taking a regulation-making power now that requires Scottish ministers to make regulations prescribing matters that have yet to be reviewed. The amendment requires that regulations must be made. That is not appropriate or sensible before the outcome of that review. I am also concerned by the definition of psychotropic substances. The reference to the convention will capture the list of substances in the schedules fixed at the point in time that the provision is commenced. Any later changes to those schedules would not be reflected. That would have the effect that newly regulated substances could not be captured by the safeguards and the regulations, and substances no longer listed would continue to be. On that basis, given the work that is underway or will be underway, I asked Dr Simpson not to press his amendment on the basis of these significant problems with the amendment, and strongly urge members to vote against it should he choose to do so.
Thank you. Can I now invite Dr Simpson to wind up and indicate if you intend to press or withdraw, please?
It is certainly true, Deputy Presiding Officer, that the amendment moved at 109 was a much more specific amendment requiring action and detailing that action. And that is, I think, what the member, Adam Ingram, moving that motion felt was appropriate, and I did support him in that. However, on discussion with the Minister, which was a very welcome opportunity to review this, it was decided that we should actually not do that, but give the Minister power as a backup for the excellent work that he's already doing to bring in regulations at a point where he felt that was necessary. Now, this government has a history of not actually bringing forward regulations when they appeared not to feel it was necessary. For example, the responsibility levy in the 2009 Alcohol Act. We're still waiting for regulations on that. So the government doesn't have to bring these regulations in. They can bring them in at a point if they feel that this is actually appropriate.
Minister.
Given that such regulations would apply very specifically to the rights of individuals, does he not accept that if we put in the face of the bill a regulation-making power that we did not use, we could be leaving ourselves open to legal challenge?
Dr. Simpson.
Exactly. That is correct. That is absolutely correct. And the thing that concerns me is that we have debated this now for over 14 years. I mean, Mary Scanlon and others raised this issue in the first Parliament. It continues to be an issue, and the issue in the acute hospitals is actually getting worse. There are more cases now of people being given psychoactive drugs inappropriately by doctors who are not psychiatrically experienced. This is an abuse of those medicines, and the government should take the powers itself, only to be introduced when they need it, but they should take the powers now, and my amendment will give them that power to be introduced at a point when they believe it to be necessary. I hope that will be before someone actually does take legal action against this government, because I would regret that having to be necessary. But I will move the amendment in my name and press it.
Thank you. The member is pressing the amendment. Question then, is that amendment 24 be agreed to? Are we all agreed? Parliament is not agreed. Since this is the first division of the stage, the Parliament is now suspended for 5 minutes. Order. We will now proceed with the division on Amendment 24. This is a 30-second division. Members should please cast their votes now. Order, please. The result of the vote on amendment number 24 is yes 48, no 63. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. That then brings us to Group 2, Safeguarding of Patients' Interests. And I call Amendment 2 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 12, 14, 15, 17, 18, 21, 34 and 37. And I ask the Minister to move Amendment 2 and speak to all amendments in the group, please. And I ask the Chamber to be quiet whilst the Minister does so. Minister.
Thank you very much, President Officer. The Government amendments in this group provide further protection for patients who do not have a named person. Amendment 2 complements amendments agreed at Stage 2, which allows certain listed persons to act where a person does not have capacity and does not have a named person. It will ensure that if a patient is detained in hospital on a 72-hour emergency detention certificate, any guardian or welfare attorney who is known to the hospital managers will be informed quickly. Amendments 14, 15, 17 and 18 are minor amendments to ensure consistency in relation to the ability of guardians and welfare attorneys to obtain notification of actions and decision under the Act where there is no named person. In particular, they ensure that the relevant guardian or welfare attorney can obtain notification of a determination extending a compulsion order and of the revocation of a certificate suspended detention for patients in certain orders. Amendment 12 is a technical drafting amendment to the definition of named person in the 2003 Act and is as a consequence of the changes to remove the default named person provisions from the 2003 Act in Section 18 of the Bill. It will ensure that the definition reflects the new position that a person may not have a named person. Amendment 21 is a minor technical amendment to remove a superfluous word and, for the information of the Chamber, from Section 47(2) of the 2003 Act in consequence of amendments agreed at Stage 2 in relation to preventing conflicts of interest at medical examinations. I thank Nanette Milne for proposing Amendment 34, which I am very happy to support. I would also like to thank Voices of Experience for highlighting some of the consequences of this lack of appeal right at our meeting last month. As I noted at Stage 2, I agreed with Dr Milne's policy intention in this matter and intended to ensure that this appeal right was covered by revised cross-border transfer regulations. However, I agree that it is useful to include this in the primary legislation and put it beyond any doubt that named persons should have the right to appeal a cross-border transfer to the Tribunal. I am also pleased that the amendment reflects Section 20A of the Bill and will ensure that regulations provide a right of appeal where the patient does not have a named person. I encourage members to support Amendment 34. I thank Nanette Milne for raising Amendment 37 and taking the time to discuss it with me after Stage 2. The amendments I proposed at Stage 2 will ensure that patients without capacity to lodge an appeal will not be disadvantaged in relation to appealing decision of the Tribunal. Currently, the named person and any guardian or welfare attorney can make such an appeal. After the Bill's passage, that option will also be available to the carer or nearest relative if there is no named person. If the curator is concerned about the decision of the Tribunal, then the curator will be able to advise the named person or others of their concerns. I did carefully consider whether there was any reason not to extend the right of appeal to the curator. My concern is that given the number of parties that can lodge an appeal, this would only be needed where there is disagreement between the curator and those with the right of appeal. It is not hard to envisage a scenario where, for example, the family member or carer and the curator disagree as to whether it would be in the best interest of the patient to appeal, where the curator has made a valid case for appeal, but the other parties feel this could be disrupted for the patient or otherwise not in their interest. Currently, the decision to lodge an appeal would ultimately rest with the named person or the other listed person, such as the guardian or carer, and I am not fully convinced that we want to change that balance so that the curator can lodge an appeal against their wishes. For that reason, I would ask Nanette Milne not to press Amendment 37, and I move Amendment 2 in my name.
Thank you. And I now call Nanette Millen to speak to Amendment 34 and the other amendments in the group, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Amendment 34 relates to decisions on cross-border transfers of patients under detention in Scotland. At present, the 2003 Act requires that regulations make provision for a patient to appeal against such a decision. This amendment will extend that right in statute to a patient's named person. In cases where a patient doesn't have a named person, the amendment allows for an appeal to be made by the person's guardian, welfare attorney, primary carer or nearest relative. As there is currently no highly secure provision for women and young people in Scotland, transfers of this nature are a common feature of our compulsory care landscape. It's in keeping with the spirit of the bill that powers to appeal in these cases rest not only with the patient, but also with other persons who may act on their behalf. Amendment 2 provides additional notice provisions adding for a detained person, adding guardians and welfare attorneys to those notified when a person is made subject to emergency detention. Amendments 14, 15, 17 and 18 relate to powers in cases where a patient has no named person, and amendments 12 and 21 are minor technical and drafting amendments. My second amendment in this group, Amendment 37, creates a right of appeal for curators ad litem to the Sheriff Principal and to the Court of Session in respect of particular decisions of the Tribunal as set out in Section 320 of the 2003 Act. At present, patients with capacity can instruct a solicitor to appeal on his or her behalf in these circumstances, but a patient who lacks capacity and consequently has a curator appointed cannot. This gap in provision could well give rise to concerns both under the European Convention on Human Rights and the UN Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities. When this was proposed at Stage 2 on suggestion of the Law Society of Scotland, the Minister agreed to consider its merits. He has since expressed the view that the gap identified by the Society at Stage 2 has been addressed through Section 20A of the Bill, ensuring that where there is no named person, the carer or nearest relative can also appeal. The Minister also questioned whether in situations where there is a disagreement between the curator and the named person or others with a right of appeal, the curator should have the ability to overrule the named person or others and appeal in such a circumstance. On this point, the Law Society does not share his view that the new Section 20A would address its concerns. Within the tribunal system, the curator ad litem is the only person whose sole function is to act purely in the interest of the patient. While there are many named persons, carers and relatives who absolutely have the patient's best interests in mind, unfortunately there are also occasions where their position is at odds with that of the patient's interests. There are also concerns where, as well as having no named person, the patient will have no carer or relative to appeal any decision of the tribunal that's not in his or her best interests. As such, the Law Society is of the view that the right of the appeal could be both useful in instances where there's a named person and where there's not, which is why Section 20A does not adequately fill the gap. In response to the Minister's concern about giving the curator the power to effectively overrule the named person or other relevant party, the Law Society would stress, first of all, that this power would not be exercised lightly or in practice regularly. It would only be exercised in situations where either there was no one else to appeal on the patient's behalf or the curator believed that the right was or was not being exercised in the patient's best interests, which, as I've already stressed, is the curator's sole motivation. Presiding Officer, I move Amendment 34.
Thank you. Can I ask the Minister to wind up, please?
Indeed, Presiding Officer, I'll direct most of my remarks in relation to the amendment from Nanette Mullen. I think the words I spoke earlier for the rest of the group speak for themselves. In relation to Amendment 37, the amendment does not just give the right of appeal to curators ad litem and where no one else can appeal, but in all cases, Section 20A of the bill means that not only will the patient, named person, guardian, welfare attorney be able to lodge an appeal, but where there is no named person, the carer or nearest relative will too. We believe, the government believes, that this does not leave a gap for vulnerable patients. My main concern here is that currently the curator can recommend to the named person or others with right of appeal that they should lodge an appeal. However, it may be the named person or the others with the right of appeal do not think this is in the patient's best interest, for example, because they were concerned that it could be disruptive to the patient. The ultimate decision to appeal therefore would lie with the named person, guardian, welfare attorney, carer or nearest relative. I note that the Law Society has suggested that the named person may not act in the best interests of the patient. However, it may also be the case that both parties have a different view of what the best interest of the patient is. I think the current balance lies with the named person and the others I have listed, as they have the ultimate decision. I am not convinced we should change this to allow the curator to overrule the named person, guardian or care. I think that would be quite a substantial change to current practice, and this is why I cannot support the amendment.
Thank you very much. The question then is that Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are. That brings us to Group 3, Suspension of Detention. And I call Amendment 3 in the name of the Minister, which is grouped with Amendments 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 13 and 16. And I ask the Minister to move Amendment 3, please, and speak to all of the amendments in the group.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The bill makes changes to the provisions in relation to the suspension of detention to provide a more effective system for calculating the maximum allowable period in any 12-month period following recommendations in the McManus report. This maximum will now be 200 days, and the bill clearly sets out how periods of suspension should be counted towards this total. This will address the confusion under the current Act when totting up individual periods of suspension of detention. We'd also introduced provisions derived from McManus recommendations to allow this total to be extended by a further 100 days with the agreement of the Mental Health Tribunal. There were concerns raised with this approach, but we wanted to try to provide some flexibility in the very small number of cases identified by the report where variation to community-based order might not yet be appropriate.
Can I stop you for a moment, Minister? There's far too much conversation going on in the chamber. Can we please be quiet and give the Minister some respect? Minister.
I certainly appreciate that, Presiding Officer. Thank you very much. However, in relation to the provision that we set out at Stage 2, I only wanted to take this forward. I only wanted to introduce the provision on the basis that we could get it exactly right with a solution that is effective and workable in practice, and that has not proved possible. The Mental Welfare Commission and others did not feel these additional days were needed in any case, and there was no clear and simple way to achieve the aim that we had set out of flexibility. I have reflected further on the concerns raised by stakeholders and important points raised by Richard Simpson at Stage 2, for which I express my thanks here. I propose that the provisions related to increasing the total by a further 100 days are removed. This is achieved by Amendments 3, 5, 7, 9 and 10. Amendments 4 and 8 ensure that the maximum total of 200 days is in any 12-month period in a way that relates appropriately to how Section 8 of the Bill expresses a period of suspension of detention. Amendments 13 and 16 make changes to Section 20A of the Bill as a consequence of these other amendments. Amendment 6 ensures clarity in relation to counting the total allowed period of 90 days for suspending measures other than detention. Throughout the progress of the Bill, I have tried to ensure that service users' rights and interests are protected and the system made more effective for them. I believe that these amendments help achieve this in relation to suspension of detention, and I move Amendment 3.
Many thanks. The question then is that Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. I now call Amendments 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 and 10, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. And I invite the Minister to move Amendments 4 to 10 on block.
Moved.
Thank you, Minister. Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 4 to 10? Since no member objects, the question then is that Amendments 4 to 10 are agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are. That then brings us to Group 4, Excessive Security. And I call Amendment 25 in the name of Dr. Richard Simpson, grouped with Amendments 11, 26 and 23. And I ask Dr. Simpson to move Amendment 25 and speak to all amendments in the group, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. 25 is a technical amendment which extends the regulation making power to all units or qualifying hospitals other than the state hospital. Amendment 26 would require a review of all security before further regulations. I moved an extensive amendment at Stage 2 seeking to recognise that apart from the state hospital, levels of security in mental health units are no longer discrete at discrete levels but almost a continuum. As it stands, the proposed bill and the accompanying regulations, which I must say were very helpfully provided by the government at an early stage in this debate, refer only to the three units previously designated as medium secure. These are Stob Hill, Glasgow Orchard Clinic at the Royal Edinburgh and the unit, new unit at the Murray Royal. But, colleagues, the amendment now to be enacted is only, in my view, a partial response to the Supreme Court judgment, which found that the Scottish Government had failed to make regulations to allow a patient in secure hospital other than the state hospital to appeal if they consider that they are being held in conditions of excessive security. It must be noticed, however, that the appellant in that case had been in a low security unit at Levendale for a decade. The amendment which I am moving today, which requires a review, is supported by SAMH, the Scottish Human Rights Commission, the Law Society, the Equality and Human Rights Commission, the Scottish Independent Advocacy Alliance, the Centre for Mental Health and the Incapacity Law and Inclusion Scotland. I believe that the time has come for patients to have the right to appeal against any level of security without the order being rescinded, the detention order being rescinded. But the purpose of Amendments 25 and 26 are to recognise this will not be straightforward. So rather than seeking to introduce a global measure at this stage immediately, Amendment 26 seeks a review of all levels of security before, before regulations are introduced covering all levels of security. To make sure that we are not taken back to court by failure to introduce regulations, I've included a time limit on this occasion to ensure that it is actually followed up. I realise that the Mental Welfare Commission actually have some slight doubts about the narrow nature of my amendment. They feel that actually we will need to look at more than just simply the estate and the levels of security in those estates, but actually at the overall situation. That, of course, is possible without further regulation, but I believe that this review of what is now a continuum should be followed, and I therefore move Amendment 25 in my name.
Thank you. Can members ensure, please, that all electronic devices are switched off or, at the very least, on silent? I call Malcolm Chisholm.
Presiding Officer.
Mr Chisholm, it's the Minister first. I call the Minister to speak to Amendment 11 and other amendments in the group, after which I will call Malcolm Chisholm.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. These amendments relate to appeals against being detained in conditions of excessive security in hospitals other than the state hospital. The Government's stated policy intention has been set out in the draft regulations and draft timetable for the introduction of the right of appeal out with the state hospital provided to the committee on the 24th of April, as alluded to by Dr Simpson. This demonstrates, I believe, our commitment to bringing regulations into force as soon as possible after Royal Assent. Amendments 11 and 23 introduce a new provision allowing the regulation-making powers introduced by Section 11 of the Bill to be exercised in advance of the provisions being fully commenced and ensuring that provision will come into force on the day after the Bill receives Royal Assent. This will ensure that as soon as possible after the Bill is passed, ministers are able to make the regulations which will be necessary for the excessive security appeal system to become operational. This will fulfil the intention at the time of the 2003 Act to enable patients in the state hospital and those in medium secure units to seek a move to a lower level of security. That was the Milan recommendation. We do not seek to extend the scheme provided for in 2003 to persons or purposes it was never intended to cover. Dr Simpson's Amendment 25 seeks to do just that by defining qualifying hospital as a hospital that is not a state hospital. It would give a right of appeal to all patients. However, Dr Simpson has already said at stage two that mental health professionals are not yet ready for an appeal right for patients in low secure units. We are also clear that an extension of the right of appeal to all such patients would require to be supported by a more fundamental reworking of the provisions of the 2003 Act, which this amendment does not propose to address. So, with respect, I am unable to support such an amendment. Dr Simpson's other amendment, Amendment 26, takes a different approach by requiring the Mental Welfare Commission to carry out a review to establish the levels of security to which patients detained in hospital are subject. However, broadly speaking, levels of security are high, medium and low, and it is already clear when patients are in high security in the state hospital and the medium secure units of Orchard Clinic in Edinburgh, Roundbank Clinic in Glasgow, and the medium secure service at Rohalion Clinic in Perth. And therefore, it is clear when a patient is detained in low secure conditions. It is not clear what the proposed review by the Commission in the terms proposed could achieve. In relation to Dr Simpson's remarks about the illegal appeal, it is indeed correct that it was taken forward by a patient in the low secure estate, but that in itself is incidental. The ruling of the court did not relate to that. In fact, the Supreme Court judgment was only on the basis that regulations had not been made. The court did not express any view on who the right of appeal should extent. I think it is important to place that on the record. Amendment 26 also would require ministers to make regulations within a set period of time to implement any recommendations the Commission makes about regulations under Section 271A1A, or of not doing so, to report to the Commission as to why not. We understand the intention behind this amendment to be to allow a right of appeal beyond medium security to be introduced within a maximum of 4 years, if that is recommended by the Commission. However, we have been clear if there was a wish to change the nature of the appeal in a way that it could be essentially extended to all patients, that would require to be supported by a more fundamental reworking of the scheme in the 2003 Act, which this amendment does not provide for. Patients in low security are subject to detentions in conditions of lesser security than patients in the state hospital and those in medium security. They are more likely to be treated in hospitals closer to their communities and have gradually increasing periods of time with the hospital ward, with up to 200 days suspension of detention in any 12 months as they progress to overnight passes and finally discharge. There are no indications that being in a low secure unit poses a barrier to rehabilitation, to release into community. There are also other applications that may be made under the 2003 Act, which would allow such patients to seek to vary or revoke their detention orders and appeal by patients in low security is likely to be an appeal against detention, and there is already a mechanism for contesting compulsory treatment. For all these reasons, I am again unable to support such an amendment.
Many thanks. And now I call Malcolm Chisholm.
Presiding Officer, at the end of the consideration of the Mental Health Bill in 2003, the current Secretary of State for Health, who was leading for the SNP on health at that time, said, and I quote, "For me, the most satisfying aspect of the bill is that it enshrines in statute the right to appeal against excessive security." So I think that just gives you some context about how important this particular aspect of this bill is. And of course, Mary Scanlon also made her mark in those debates, because it was her amendment that ensured that regulation should be made by May 2006. And as a result of that, there was one of those rare occasions, because my government and this government didn't make regulations, it ended up in the Supreme Court. And of course, that is why we have the Minister's Amendment, with the very unusual regulations maybe made before the Act comes into force, because there is a requirement from the Supreme Court that regulations are made. Now, the Minister says that it's irrelevant that the person taking the case to the Supreme Court was in low security, but the fact of the matter is that his appeal would not have been valid at all if the Act had specifically said it's only about those in medium security. That was never in the original Act. Now, Richard Simpson's amendment is a very modest amendment, because he's not demanding that, that we should decide today that people in low security should have the right of appeal. He's merely saying the Mental Welfare Commission should do a review of levels of security which can inform regulations at a future date. And since the Minister is talking so much about the intentions of the 2003 Act, the reality is that what drove the change then was the principle of the least restrictive manner and environment compatible with the delivery of safe and effective care. That was a fundamental principle of the Mental Health Act, and that applies as much to somebody in low security as in medium security. There is no reference to medium security in the 2003 clauses. There were clauses that were looking to the future, because of course everyone was saying then the estate has to be developed, so we have different levels of security. It was a clause that was looking to the future. It talked about a qualifying patient in a qualifying hospital, and I note that when the Mental Welfare Commission had a major event consulting on this, the conclusion was that qualifying hospitals should include low security. And as Richard Simpson says, that's the view of SAMH, the Scottish Human Rights Commission, the Law Society, the Equality and Human Rights Commission, the Scottish Independence Advocacy Alliance, and I could go on. So this is a very modest amendment. We're not insisting that low security patients are given this right. We're saying that there should be an amendment that investigates that issue to make that a possibility of the regulations that have to come in due course. Now, I have a general concern and conclusion that for the last 12 years, the government, and that includes both governments, have been dragging their feet on this issue. I have a concern myself that even in terms of the government's plans for medium secure, clause 271A3B talks about further requirements for the test to be met over and above the excessive level of security, but that's passed by without an amendment. But I do think we have an opportunity today to broaden out this right of appeal in accordance with the fundamental Milan principle of the least restrictive manner and environment compatible with the delivery and safe of effective care. And my last word to the Minister is, be inspired by what the Cabinet Secretary said in 2003 about this provision.
Thank you very much. Mary Scanlon.
Thank you. Malcolm Chisholm did mention a rare occasion, and it is a rare occasion indeed when a Conservative MSP gets unanimous support across the Parliament for an amendment. It was in 2003, and uniquely it is an amendment that's ended up in the Supreme Court. But I did want to reiterate the point that Malcolm Chisholm made, because it shouldn't not be lost. The 2003 Act was based on 10 principles, the Milan principles, and number 8 of those principles is the least restrictive alternative. Service users should be provided with any necessary care, treatment and support, both in the least invasive manner and in the least restrictive manner. That was the principle on which the 2003 Act was based. So it was an understanding throughout all of us. And when I look back to my speech in 2003 and speaking to that amendment, I did use the case of the state hospital at Carstairs, because at that time there were 29 blocked beds. There were no medium secure units to move people onto. So I gave that as an example of excessive security. But the understanding, and Shona Robinson Nicola and so many others were on the Health Committee at that time, the understanding was that you can have excessive security whether you're in Carstairs or if you're in your local psychiatric hospital. It was excessive security, whether it was Carstairs, medium secure, low secure, or psychiatric hospital. And that is because the basic Milan principle applied of the least restrictive alternative. So I'm very much in favour of Richard Simpson and Malcolm Chisholm, who were both in the Health Committee at that time, but I'm very much in favour of Richard's amendment, and I do think we should all support it today. And if we take one thing from that 2003 Act and the many, many emails and the many, many issues that are raised in the cross-party group on mental health, the many issues that have been raised in the last 12 years, this is one fundamental principle that we unanimously agreed on, based on the Milan principles in 2003, and we should all today, I believe, support Richard Simpson.
Many thanks, and I now invite Dr. Richard Simpson to wind up and indicate if you intend to press or withdraw, please.
I have tried, Presiding Officer, to be not overly prescriptive. I mean, I just want to take two parts of the amendment. Although it does require the ministers within a year of receiving the report from the Mental Welfare Commission to make regulations, there's an escape clause. If the ministers don't plan to make such regulations, they publish a response to the report setting out their reasons for doing so. This is an incredibly modest approach to something supported by 9 organisations. I forgot to include the Royal College, who've actually supported the Mental Welfare Commission's position on this. This is something that we really should undertake now. And not to do so, I think, frankly, is an affront to these 9 organisations and is not, in fact, supporting the basic 8th principle of Milan. So I'm really appalled if the government are going to use their majority on this occasion simply to vote down this very modest amendment. I move them in my name.
Many thanks. The question then is that Amendment 25 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division. This will be a 1 minute division. Please vote now. The result of the vote on amendment number 25 is yes 52, no 61. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. I now call amendment 11 in the name of the Minister, already debated with amendment 25. And I ask the Minister to move formally, please. Many thanks. The question is that amendment 11 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are. I now call amendment 26 in the name of Dr. Richard Simpson, already debated with amendment 25. And I ask Dr. Simpson to move or not move.
Moved.
The question then is that amendment 26 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division. This division will be 30 seconds. Please vote now. The result of the vote on amendment number 26 is yes 52, no 62. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. I now call amendments 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17 and 18, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated. And I invite the Minister to move amendments 12 to 18 en bloc, please.
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. Does any member object to a single question being put on amendments 12 to 18? Since no member has objected, the question then is that amendments 12 to 18 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. That then brings us to Group 5, Advance Statement, and I call amendment 27 in the name of Dr. Richard Simpson, grouped with amendments 19, 20 and 28. And ask Dr. Simpson to move Amendment 27 and speak to all of the amendments in the group, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. At stage two, I moved Amendment 88, which attempted to ensure that the wishes of the patients expressed while having full capacity in an advance statement should then be respected. Whilst I hope the Minister today is going to support Jackie Bailey's Amendment 1 later, this amendment makes another attempt to ensure that where the patient makes it absolutely clear that under no circumstances whatsoever do they wish to receive treatment, that right to refuse treatment should be respected. It is in respect of physical illness. Patients are entitled, even if they're going to die, they are entitled to refuse treatment if they have full capacity. What I'm now proposing is that the Minister should be able in regulations to determine exactly the circumstances in which this right should be fully respected. I appreciate that under the Mental Health Act 2003, there is a requirement and indeed an obligation upon both the responsible medical officer and the tribunal to make very clear as to why and in what circumstances they've chosen to overrule the patient's advance statement. However, I believe that there are limited circumstances in which the patient has an absolute as opposed to a partial right, and these should be defined. For example, if the patient chooses that under no circumstances should they be treated with ECT or with a specific psychotropic or psychoactive substance, then I believe that provided that that has been determined only when they have full capacity, written in their advance statement, witnessed by someone such as their GP or a psychiatrist in whom they have confidence, then it should not be overridden in circumstances where a physical illness exists, which might indeed be fatal. A patient with capacity is entitled to refuse treatment, yet a patient with mental illness who's previously stated in writing, in a witness statement, that they wish to refuse treatment can be overridden. This is yet another gap between the parity of esteem between mental health patients and physical patients. The need for regulations is, for example, to ensure that whether a named person or indeed anyone like a next of kin is conscious that the patient, notwithstanding their advance statement, has actually changed their mind but hadn't withdrawn the statement, then it could still be overridden. And that's why I've moved it as regulations. I look forward to the Minister speaking on Amendments 19 and 20, and I very much welcome the Amendment 28 in the name of Bob Dorris, as it's clear that it will move towards achieving what we all want in the form of greater awareness and hopefully a higher use of advanced statements.
Thank you. Can I now invite the Minister to speak to Amendment 19 and other amendments in the group, please, Minister?
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I thank Dr Simpson for talking to his amendment. I look forward to hearing what Mr Dorris has to say. And a second relation to Dr Simpson's amendment, I understand that his concerns relate to the capacity of patients in situations where wishes set out in advance statements should or must be adhered to. However, with respect, I'm not clear what circumstances as envisaged be set out in the proposed regulations. The current framework ensures that doctors and tribunals take account of advance statements and require them to set out reasons why they are overridden whenever this is the case. A competently made advance statement is a strong indication of a patient's wishes about medical treatment, but should not be considered in isolation. There must be flexibility. An advance statement cannot bind the medical practitioner or member of the care team to do anything illegal or unethical, nor can it bind the medical practitioner or member of the care team to provide, arrange or withhold specific services, medicines or treatments. I'm aware that the Commission, the Mental Welfare Commission, has raised concerns that changing the balanced approach in the current legislation could lead to dilemmas in cases where not giving treatment could result in severe harm. I recognise the positive intentions behind this amendment, but would be concerned about unintended consequences such as these. I think we should heed the concerns of the Commission. Given also, President Officer, that we would not intend to use the proposed regulation making powers and the difficulties that can potentially ensue where we agree a regulation making power but do not use it with respect, I cannot support this amendment. I would ask Dr Simpson not to press his amendment. I thank Mr Dorris for proposing his amendment, Amendment 28, which I am very happy to support. The Government sees advance statements as an important tool in helping service users participate in decisions about their treatment when they are not well, and we want to see their use increase. I am confident that, taken with the other measures introduced in the bill, this amendment will help increase numbers of advance statements being made. I am aware that sometimes service users are not sure about how to access support to make an advance statement. This amendment will make sure that service users have information about who in their treatment team or which other medical professional can help them with making an advance statement and what support they can expect. It will also allow the... Yes?
Malcolm Chisholm.
But is there anything that he can do, either through regulations or probably through guidance, to promote advance statements and get the relevant authorities, particularly health boards, to promote advance statements as well?
Minister.
Well, indeed, I would recognise that this can't be the sum total of what we do to promote advance statements. I think it's an important step in that regard. What I can say is that I will also ask the working group, which will be updating the code of practice, include guidance in the code setting out best practices to how health boards could work with others such as local authorities and other organisations in their area to produce and promote information about support available to anyone in their area to make an advance statement. That is of course beyond the support directly available by the health board itself, so hopefully that would be of further assistance in that regard, President Officer. I would urge members to support Mr Dorris's amendment. I don't think I've quite bottomed out his amendment. I also think it's important that it will allow the Mental Welfare Commission to get the information it needs to find out what support is being offered to help with the work they are undertaking to promote greater use of advance statements. And again, I think that will help with the concern that's been expressed by Malcolm Chisholm. The purpose of Amendments 19 and 20 in my name are simply to tidy up the provisions that were amended at Stage 2 in relation to registering advance statements. They are minor technical changes that have no policy effect. Thank you, President Officer.
Many thanks. I now invite Bob Dorris to speak to Amendment 28 and the other amendments in the group, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. At Stage 1 of this process, several witnesses highlighted that the use of advance statements were rare. This is, of course, worrying because we would all, or at least I'm sure most of us, would want to see future treatment and care to be informed or directed in accordance with our wishes, assuming that that were appropriate and possible, that they be respected, even after we're no longer in a position to clearly express what those wishes are. That's the drive behind the validity of advance statements that we have to promote. At stage two, I proposed a detailed amendment placing duties and health boards to regularly publish and promote various requirements in terms of advance statements, and I could not persuade the Scottish Government at that point. They believed it was over-prescriptive and they didn't believe it would drive the change that was required. But I did promise to go away and work on this further, which I've now done with bringing an amendment here at stage three. So Amendment 20 inserts new provisions into section 21 of the bill, which relates to advance statements. It would insert a new section at 276D to the 2003 Act to impose duties on health boards in relation to publicising support for making advance statements, but not in a way that would be overly prescriptive. The effect is to require health boards to publicise support offered by the boards for persons to make or withdraw an advance statement, as well as any support it offers for persons wishing to provide a copy to the boards in accordance with subsection 1. Crucially for myself, presiding officer, the health board is also required to provide information to the Mental Welfare Commission about what it is doing to comply with subsection 1 when requested to do so by the Commission. I believe the Mental Welfare Commission have a crucial role in garnering that information and driving the change, which is why I have placed Amendment 28 before Parliament. Briefly in relation to Amendment 27, presiding officer, I do have some concerns in relation to the binding nature of advance statements, or the absolute binding nature of advance statements. I said at the start of my contribution that uptake and the use of advance statements was very, very rare. I think we have to assume then that the revision, an amendment to advance statements, because people's will and decision, whilst they still have capacity, will change over a period of time. And we have no idea, presiding officer, how attentive those advance statements that are in existence, how attentive authorities are to having those regularly revised and updated. So because of those concerns, I can't support Amendment 27, and I would appreciate the support of Parliament today for my amendment, Amendment 28.
Many thanks. And can I now ask Dr. Richard Simpson to wind up and indicate, please, if you intend to press or withdraw.
Thank you. Amendments 19, 20 and 28 are very welcome. The Minister said that I haven't defined the circumstances which would apply to the absolute right in an advance statement. This was completely deliberate. It was designed to allow the Minister to define those circumstances after consulting with those who feel that their wishes have been previously flouted by the Tribunal. This is a rare occurrence, but nevertheless, I believe that the time has come for patients to be given the right to refuse treatment if they choose to do so. Answering Bob Doris's point in his speech about the fact that people's wishes may change over time, they do, of course, have the right to withdraw a statement, which is entirely appropriate. But even if they do not do so, then in regulations it would be perfectly possible to say that if they actually talk to their GP or psychiatrist, or talk to the named person or the next of kin, and indicated that actually they think that advance statement should no longer apply, those circumstances could then apply. So there would be get-out clauses in carefully drawn regulations, but not to allow people who have got full capacity to then have a right, absolutely, if they define it very clearly. And this is not a general thing that I don't want to be treated, but it is about absolutely specific treatments. And if that is still not going to be allowed, I think that this is an infringement of individuals' human rights, and we may well be challenged as a Parliament on this in future. This gives the Minister power to make regulations at that point if he wishes to do so, and I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. The question then is that Amendment 27 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division. This will be a 1 minute division. Please vote now. The result of the vote on amendment number 27 is yes 52, no 59. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. I now call amendment 19 in the name of the Minister and already debated with amendment 27. And I ask the Minister to move formally, please.
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. Question is that amendment 19 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. I call Amendment 20 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 27, and I ask the Minister to move formally.
It moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. Question is that Amendment 20 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. I now call Amendment 28 in the name of Bob Dorris, which has already been debated with Amendment 27, and I ask Bob Dorris to move or not to move.
Moved.
Thank you. The Member has moved. The question then is that Amendment 28 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. That then brings us to Group 6, Advocacy Services, and I call Amendment 29 in the name of the Minister, which is grouped with Amendments 30 and 31, and I ask the Minister to move Amendment 29, please, and speak to all of the amendments in the group.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Richard Simpson lodged a number of amendments at Stage 2 relating to Advocacy Services. I had useful meetings with Dr. Simpson following Stage 2, and I thank him again for his work on these issues. Amendment 29 in my name relates to monitoring of advocacy provision. I'm committed to working with Dr. Simpson on this issue at Stage 3. While Dr. Simpson lodged amendment at Stage 3 on this issue, he has withdrawn it, and I hope he can support my amendment instead. The amendment in my name varies from the amendment which Dr. Simpson lodged at Stage 2 in the following ways. It adds the State Hospitals Board for Scotland to the list of bodies which must report to the Mental Welfare Commission on the exercise of their functions under the Act. It removes the provision which set out the requirement of the Commission to monitor the provision of services and report to the Scottish Ministers. The Act contains a general duty on the Mental Welfare Commission to monitor and report on the operation of the Act, and I do not believe that it is necessary to add a specific provision on this point. It allows the Mental Welfare Commission to seek information from local authorities, health boards and the State Hospital at times decided by the Commission, covering a period of operation of 2 years or more. I accept, Presiding Officer, that people's experience of accessing advocacy does not always meet their expectations. It is important that we understand that and ensure that people are able to access services and their rights. I believe this amendment will help achieve this. Richard Simpson also introduced amendments at Stage 2 which would have made provision for rights for advocates that go well beyond the role that advocates have under the 2003 Act, that is, to assist the patient to access their rights. The amendments would have fundamentally changed the nature of advocates' role by giving them rights which they could exercise independently of the patient to make representations, access information and lead and produce evidence at the tribunal. I resisted them on that basis. Whilst the amendments 30 and 31 simply allowed for regulations to be made to set out the circumstances in which advocates must be informed or be allowed to make representations, I remain of the view that the role of advocates should not be extended in this way, whether this is done by primary legislation or in regulations, nor as a general position. I've made this point in other debates and other groups. Can I support the government taking powers to make regulations when we cannot envisage the circumstances which we would seek as a matter of policy to exercise them? On that basis, I do not support the amendments. I noted at Stage 2 that the amendments may, at least in part, have been developed to fill a gap which is created by removing the default position of having a named person where a person is not appointed, a named person where the person is not able to act on their own behalf. A government amendment was passed at Stage 2 which addressed that situation by including a limited list of people who can act in limited circumstances on behalf of a patient who does not have a named person and who is not able to act on their own behalf, and we've covered some of that in an earlier debate. I would ask Richard Simpson not to press his amendments, and should he do so, that members do not support them, and I move Amendment 29.
Many thanks. I now call on Dr. Richard Simpson to speak to Amendment 30 and other amendments in the group, please.
Can I begin by thanking the Minister for meeting me on this issue and also for tabling Amendment 29, with which I fully concur. I think it's a very welcome move. The Scottish Independent Advocacy Alliance in research carried out in May 2015 showed that only 6 out of 14 geographical NHS boards have current strategic advocacy plans, and a significant proportion of these will be expiring soon, and only one board actually said they were going to update the plan. So allowing the Mental Welfare Commission to look at this in a much more stringent way is indeed very welcome. However, my amendments 30 and 31, to which I want to now speak, are designed specifically to ensure that the advocacy service are further strengthened. The reason for this is that until the point at which the named person default system was withdrawn and the person could end up without a named person, indeed without any other person acting in their interest, then the role of the advocate was, as the Minister said, quite circumscribed, and that was entirely appropriate. However, in the new circumstances brought about by the amendments to the Act in this bill, produced by the government itself, the advocates should, in the Amendment 30, at least be notified by the tribunal. And that is this notification, circumstances in which others would be notified, but if these others don't exist, then the advocate should surely be notified. That amendment, at least, I think, does not extend their powers. It simply notifies them of certain things when no one else is around to be notified. Now, Amendment 31 I accept as a little more contentious because it does extend the role of the advocate, again, only in circumstances where there are no other people around to actually make applications or make representations on behalf of the patient who is presumed to have reduced capacity or seriously impaired decision-making ability and therefore, in fact, may not be able to make those representations or applications themselves, and nobody else is available except perhaps the responsible medical officer. And it may be that the patient actually would not agree with the notifications or representations of that responsible medical officer, and therefore someone else should be in a position to do that. But I accept that this may be a step too far, but I will be pressing Amendment 30. Thank you.
Many thanks. Now Colin Malcolm Chisholm.
Presiding Officer, just briefly, I mean, obviously this is a very important part of the bill, and I very much welcome the amendment that Jamie Hepburn has brought forward. It was a notable omission when the bill was first published that there was nothing about advocacy. In fact, this is one of the main issues that the Equal Opportunities Committee dealt with when they did some work on the McManus Review in 2010. As we know, the 2003 Act said that every person with a mental disorder should have a right of access to independent advocacy, and in practice it's often been targeted at people subject to compulsory proceedings, and as Richard Simpson says, the recent review highlighted problems in a large number of boards, so I very much welcome the fact that boards and local authorities will be accountable to the Mental Welfare Commission and that there will be more scrutiny of strategic advocacy plans. So I think the whole chamber will be pleased about that. I mean, I think Richard Simpson's amendments are very interesting. I always follow the advice of the Scottish Independence Advocacy Alliance, and on 30, I think they accept it with qualifications, saying as long as the Code of Practice provides more detail about ensuring advocates don't have access to information, they don't have the person's permission to see. So presumably, since it's an amendment about regulations, that could be covered by them. So I'm glad that Richard Simpson is pressing that. I take it I'm not sure if he's pressing 31 or not, so I'm not sure whether I should say what I'm going to say or not. But there is a very interesting dimension to Amendment 31, because although Jamie Hepburn says it's beyond the 2003 Act, the Mental Health Bill as drafted did have a clause 1824B, which said that those affected by their mental disorder, so affected by it that they cannot express an opinion, should have an advocate. That was in the bill, and it was the Health Committee at that time who objected to that, presumably for the same kind of reasons that Jamie Hepburn is presenting now. So I could go either way on that one, and I'll see what Richard Simpson advises.
Minister? Wind up.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and can I thank Richard Simpson for setting out his support for Amendment 29, indeed Malcolm Chisholm for his comments. I agree very much, it should improve the situation. Can I focus on the protections for patients without capacity that are now in the face of this bill? At stage two, I proposed amendments that would remove the default named person provision from the 2003 Act, which that was widely supported, but we also introduced protections for patients without capacity. This included that where there is no named person, the guardian, welfare attorney, carer or nearest relative could initiate an application or appeal to the tribunal. Under the existing provisions of the 2003 Act, a curator ad litem can also be appointed to protect the patient's legal interests where the patient does not have the capacity to instruct legal representation. So the Act and the Bill therefore do already provide strong protections for patients without capacity. Turning to the issue about the changing the role of the advocate, an independent advocate helps a patient understand their rights and communicate their wishes and views. They do not act independently of the patient, and I think Dr Simpson's amendment 31 in particular would look to give them such an independent role. I'm not clear that this is desirable, particularly in relation to appeals, and I'm not particularly convinced that such a move has been particularly widely consulted on. I think it was interesting that Malcolm Chisholm made the point that there was provision in the face of the bill as drafted in 2003 and that was removed. I think it was removed for good reason. I think the reasons still stand just now. In terms of notifications, there are already certain circumstances where the Code of Practice sets out where it would be best practice to involve the advocate, for example, before a hospital transfer. And I believe the working group should consider further best practice guidance in relation to this, and I hope that can take care of some of the concerns around Amendment 30, which I still oppose. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. And so the question is that Amendment 29 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I now call Amendment 30 in the name of Dr. Richard Simpson. Dr. Simpson, to move or not move?
Moved.
Many thanks. And so the question is that Amendment 30 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not. There will therefore be a division. Please vote now, and this will be a 60-second division. Result of the vote, amendment number 30 is yes, 52, no, 60. There were no abstentions, and the amendment is therefore not agreed. Now call amendment 31 in the name of Dr. Richard Simpson. Dr. Simpson to move, not moved. Okay. And so we now move to amendment 21 in the name of the minister. Minister to move, please.
Presiding officer.
Thank you. So the question is that amendment 21 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are. Many thanks. We now move to Group 7. I call Amendment 33 in the name of Nanette Milne in a group on its own. Dr. Milne to move and speak to Amendment 33, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Amendment 33 seeks to provide the Scottish Ministers with the flexibility to permit by regulations professionals to perform the statutory functions of responsible medical officers under the 2003 Act who are not also approved medical practitioners. This follows an appeal by the British Psychological Society to allow practitioner psychologists involved in compulsory care to perform additional statutory duties. Currently, both the AMP and the RMO roles are the exclusive preserve of the medical profession. This is despite the primary treatments for many mental health problems being psychological, particularly in the case of patients with learning disabilities, autistic spectrum disorders, eating disorders, or personality disorders. As the clinician most responsible for and with the broadest understanding of the patient's treatment in these cases, psychologists are best placed to be able to oversee their care in this way. Following the Mental Health Act 2007, the equivalent positions in England and Wales of approved clinician and responsible clinician can be undertaken by psychologists. As a result, there is access to a wealth of guidance, treating and learning to inform how these roles could function in Scotland. And we're by no means venturing into the unknown. When this issue was raised at stage two, the Minister stated that further consultation would have to take place before additional powers of this nature were extended to psychologists. The amendment addresses that concern by allowing for any processes that the Minister may need to satisfy himself of the viability of this change to take place. At that point, he can then decide whether or not to extend the categories of eligible RMOs without further primary legislation. The amendment also extends only to the RMO position in connection with treatment. It doesn't change eligibility for the AMP position responsible for the initial process of assessment. It's worth noting that this process has already been subject to extensive scrutiny in the UK Parliament prior to the passage of the 2007 Act, which applied equivalent measures in England and Wales. The statutory positions require a great deal of work from the psychiatric profession in terms of assessment, reports and appearing at hearings. In addition to providing for the most appropriate clinician to oversee the treatment of people receiving psychological treatments, this amendment will also provide additional professional capacity to support patients undergoing compulsory care. So I move Amendment 33.
Many thanks. I now call on Malcolm Chisholm.
Presiding Officer, I support this amendment. It's a very modest proposal which uses the words may by regulation, so the Minister and the Scottish Government can be assured that on this occasion there is no prospect of them ending in the Supreme Court. They may, if they wish, not introduce regulations. And it's an attempt, really, I think it's a response to what the Minister said at committee, which Nanette Milnes alluded to, because he admitted that there was merit in considering the duties that a broader range of health professionals can undertake. So this seems to be the perfect way to progress that view that the Minister expressed at that time. And as Nanette Milne says, it only applies to the RMO, who doesn't deal with the admissions process, but with the supervision of compulsory treatment orders and advice to the Mental Health Tribunal. Now, I wouldn't normally invoke English mental health legislation, because in general Scottish mental health legislation was before it and better than it. But I think the fact that they do have a broader definition in England, a responsible clinician and an approved clinician in 2007, it does, and that there have been no problems with that. There's been post-legislative scrutiny of that legislation. No one has suggested any problems. So it does suggest that there is no fundamental reason why the definition shouldn't be broadened. In fact, if we want to look to English practice as a body of relevant guidance, training and learning, that could help us. So I don't think we should rule that out just because it's from England. But there are other reasons, as Nanette Milne has suggested. She hasn't actually mentioned a fairly practical reason, that we actually have a workforce supply issue with psychiatrists, and quite a lot of work is involved. So I would have thought a lot of psychiatrists would welcome this. And I note that the Royal College of Psychiatry briefing for today's debate does not tell us to oppose this particular amendment. But as Nanette Milne said, and hopefully the Royal College would agree with this, there are actually some treatments where it's actually better, some conditions where it's actually better, where decisions are dealt with by psychologists. And it may be people with learning disabilities. We'll hear more about that in a moment, of course. Autistic spectrum disorder, eating disorders, personality disorders, and so on. So sometimes the primary treatment for mental health problems are psychological, and we should remember this well. So I think, as I said at the beginning, this is a very modest proposal. It doesn't really commit the Minister to making a final decision about that today, but it does, in fact, I think, provide a practical way of implementing the view that he himself expressed in committee.
Many thanks. I now call on Dr. Richard Simpson.
Yes, can I apologise to Nanette Milne for my brief absence, but I do support this amendment. I think that the one thing I wanted to add to the very full remarks that I've heard from Malcolm Chisholm, which actually said most of what I wanted to say, the only thing I wanted to add is this, that this actually fits with the 2020 vision of this government. This is all about upskilling and allowing practitioners to actually participate more fully. And we have a situation where I was told the other day by a very senior member of the Royal College of Psychiatry that 42% of the psychiatrists qualifying in the UK today on the foundation exams are emigrating. We are faced with a serious workforce problem in this and many other areas. And I would suggest that upskilling psychologists is a power which the Minister would want to take so that he can undertake this by regulations without having to come back to this Parliament in order to seek a further amendment to the Act. I support the amendment in Nanette Milne's
name. Many thanks. Now calling the Minister, Jimmy Hepburn.
Thank you very much, President Officer. I thank Nanette Milne for proposing this amendment. I also thank other members who have engaged with me on this issue. Psychologists play a key role, particularly in the care and treatment of persons with learning disabilities and autism spectrum disorder. I am therefore happy to commit at this stage publicly to stating that the role played by psychologists, something I would like to see covered in the review that I previously spoke about in the debate on Amendment 24, and I look forward to working with the British Psychological Society and other professional bodies as part of this work. My concern with this amendment is that it would have the effect of extending the responsible medical officer role as a whole beyond approved medical practitioners, contrary to Nanette Milne's view that the provisions are limited. She stated the amendment would apply only to the role in relation to treatment. That is not the case as the amendment is drafted. In our interpretation of it, I'm afraid it may have been drafted more widely than was her intention. The duties of the responsible medical officer are wide-ranging, beyond supervising treatment, and include assessing the need for and authorising detention of patients for compulsory treatment of a mental disorder. Mental health services are delivered by multidisciplinary teams, and it is important different members of these teams undertake roles that allow them to most effectively support patients. Although there is now a role of approved clinician in England and Wales, which can include a psychologist under the England and Wales Act, a medical doctor is still required to assess the patient and agree to detention in a similar way that a responsible medical officer must agree under the 2003 Act in Scotland. As I have set out, the amendment does not allow the regulation to alter the specific duties of the responsible medical officer or make other adjustments such as to ensure that a doctor has assessed the patient and agreed to detention under the Act. It is not clear to me that that is what is wanted. I do not think that is what it was the intention behind Nanette Milne's amendment when she wanted to extend the role of psychologists in the face of the Act. I am not unsympathetic, of course, to the general principles behind the amendment. The amendment would only allow all duties to be extended or none. It is for that reason I urge members to vote against it, but let me emphasise this Government's clear commitment to looking at this matter with serious attention going forward.
Many thanks. So, Nanette Milne, to wind up and press to withdraw your amendment, please.
Thank you. Malcolm Chisholm absolutely got this right, in that this is a very modest amendment which may lead to change in the future without the need for further primary legislation, should ministers wish to expand the psychologist's role as time moves on. And of course, I do agree with both Malcolm Chisholm and Richard Simpson that we do have a serious workforce issue here, which this amendment, I think, could resolve, could help to resolve, certainly, in the future. So I intend to press my amendment. Thank you.
Thanks very much. And so the question is that Amendment 33 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not. There will therefore be a division, and this will be a 60-second division. Please vote now. Result of the vote, amendment number 33 is yes, 52, no, 59. There were no abstentions and the amendment is therefore not agreed. Now call amendment 34 in the name of Nanette Milne, Dr. Milne, to move or not move.
Moved.
Thank you very much. So the question is, amendment 34 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. So we now move to Group 8 and call Amendment 1 in the name of Jackie Bailey in a group on its own. Jackie Bailey to move and speak to Amendment 1, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
A bit of order, please. Thank you. Ms. Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The purpose of Amendment 1 is very simple. It requires ministers to bring forward a review of the meaning of mental disorder, specifically whether learning disability should continue to be included in that definition, and for that review to report within 3 years of royal assent of the bill. All I believe to be perfectly reasonable. At stage 2, I moved an identical amendment, but set a time limit of 1 year for the review to be complete. I listened very carefully to the minister then and at our subsequent very helpful discussion, and he argued that civil servants would be engaged in implementation of the bill, and that would mean that they would be too busy to carry out the review. He also argued, and I entirely agree with him, that it is important to ensure that those with learning disabilities were fully involved in the review, and that takes time. So this revised amendment allows up to 3 years for the review to be undertaken, plenty of time to ensure that it's thorough and it is inclusive. Can I explain to the Chamber the context of this amendment? In 2001, the Milan Committee supported the idea of removing learning disability from the definition of mental disorder. In 2009, the McManus Review also supported the idea of removing learning disability from the definition of a mental disorder, as set out in the Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act of 2003. A review was promised. So we have two separate expert committees, both recommending the same thing, yet here we are, 14 years later, and still no review. And let me be clear, this isn't party political. The previous Labour Scottish Executive didn't carry out a review. The current Scottish Government hasn't carried out a review. The Cross-Party Group on Learning Disability has discussed this at length. There is huge support from members for a review. People with learning disabilities have been patient. But today is about rewarding their patience and doing the right thing. Let me also say to the Chamber that this amendment does not in any way prejudge the outcome of such a review. I recognise that there are strongly held arguments on both sides. Some passionately believe that learning disability should not be included in a definition of mental disorder. Enable, Inclusion Scotland, People First, and many more besides. And let me set out some of their rationale. They believe, firstly, that the inclusion of people with learning disabilities in an act which clearly has as its focus the treatment of people with mental ill health conditions has a detrimental impact. Secondly, people with learning disabilities are not mentally ill. Unlike mental illness, learning disability is a lifelong condition which cannot be cured or alleviated by medication. It is an intellectual impairment rather than a mental disorder. Thirdly, people with learning disabilities may require care and support. Except where a mental illness is also present, psychiatrists are unlikely to take the lead role in providing care and support for people with a learning disability. Additionally, there is evidence that people with learning disabilities are subject to compulsory treatment as a result of their learning disability alone. They would point to people with learning disabilities accounting for more than 11% of those in mental health institutions when they represent just 2% of the population, and that their stay is longer than average. That clearly is not right. On the other hand, some will argue equally passionately that inclusion of learning disability means access to services and point to the safeguards that are inherent in the 2003 Act, so that those with a learning disability are not made subject to its provisions. So clearly, there are complex arguments here. Clearly, there are different views. But the desire for a review is long-standing. It transcends governments. It transcends ministers. The amendment does not presuppose the outcome of that review. But, you know, 14 years on, it really is time we conducted it. So I urge members to support this amendment, to listen to the views of those with learning disabilities, their families, and the organisations that support them.
Many thanks. Now call on Mark MacDonald.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I thank Jackie Bailey for her amendment and her remarks. And I looked at the discussion that was had at stage 2, and I noted the the Minister at that stage gave a commitment that a review would be undertaken. And I'll be interested to hear from the Minister in his remarks as to what the progress in relation to that is. I don't disagree with much of what Jackie Bailey has said, and indeed in meetings that I've had with organisations like, for example, National Autistic Society Scotland, there has been discussion around the views that are held regarding the inclusion of learning disability within the category of mental disorder. And I think Jackie Bailey articulates the points on that very well. She also articulates that there are strongly held views on the other side of the equation in terms of retaining it within there. And that's where the issue that I have with the amendment as framed comes, because subsection 5 states that ministers should make provision by regulation. And I believe that if we are going to have this review, have recommendations from this review, and then enact the recommendations from this review, I have a concern that provision by regulation does not perhaps allow for the fullest parliamentary scrutiny in terms of evidence taking, in terms of debate within Parliament, on something which I think Jackie Bailey has acknowledged has arguments on both sides and elements of contention. So I think the Minister has given a commitment in relation to the review. I think that Jackie Bailey has articulated the points well, but I think having provision by regulation, I feel, would not allow for the fullest debate on this to continue both during the review and afterwards. So I hope Jackie Bailey will take it in the spirit that this is not party political in any way. I agree with much of what she has said. I feel, however, that the way that the amendment is drafted does not give me comfort that we could ensure that the fullest debate was had in relation to this issue.
Thank you. I call Malcolm Chisholm.
Very modest amendment, because it is merely calling for a review and does not preempt the conclusions of that review. And goodness knows we've been hearing about reviews on this for the whole of this century. Bruce Millen has been referred to, and I can quote him. He says there should be an expert review at an early date on the position of learning disability within mental health law. And the Scottish Executive of the time, responding to that report in 2001, said in reviewing mental health law documents, said it was important to get the context for such a review right, and they said they would discuss it with the Same As You Implementation Group and the Scottish Consortium on Learning Disabilities before bringing forward proposals. Well, I regret the fact they weren't brought forward. As Jackie Bailey said, this is not a party political matter. Both main parties have failed to do that, but I do think enough years have passed now for it to be done within the next 3 years. And again, there's plenty of experience from other jurisdictions about this. For example, I note that New Zealand in 1992 changed their mental health law, and from that time people with learning disabilities were excluded unless they also had a mental illness. And that's clearly a position that a lot of people would accept. So it can be done, but this is only calling for a review, so I'm not quite clear how anybody after 15 years can still object to that.
Thanks very much. And I call on Jim Hume.
Support amendment number 1 in the name of Jackie Bailey, which seeks to set clearer and more progressive definitions of who is to be considered as having mental health disabilities. Clearly, in the 21st century, we should be expected to have the expertise to distinguish different conditions, not just through medical means, but also through legislative means. That's why this amendment is important, to delineate the more exact and specific medical conditions constituting a mental health disorder, and also to better protect both those who fall under this category and those who don't. I agree that this must be within the 3-year condition of the amendment, or else we risk failing many people and bringing more burden onto the already stretched mental health services. So with professional and expert consultation, I believe the ministers must commit to reviewing the term of mental disorder if they are serious about their priorities in mental health and also, of course, human rights. So therefore, I support Jackie Bailey's amendment.
Thanks so much. I now call on Richard Simpson.
Presiding officer. As I said at stage 2, the inclusion of learning disabilities and autism spectrum disorder in the mental health legislation was raised by a number of witnesses, and as Mark MacDonald has said, there are contrasting views on this, though I think the weight of opinion is in favour of removing learning disability from the mental disorders, at least and unless there is a mental illness accompanying it. I thought the evidence from Steve Robertson of People First which I quoted at stage two, was particularly apposite. We honestly believe, he said, that the time has come for a new piece of legislation that is just about people with learning disabilities. We think it's only right and fair that learning disability is properly defined as an intellectual impairment rather than as a mental disorder. And indeed, the faculty involved in this is just changing its name to intellectual disability. These are disabilities, these are not mental illnesses in my view, and therefore, although classifying it as a mental disorder may have appeared to be appropriate in the past, I'm not sure that it does now. However, this amendment doesn't seek to actually determine the outcome of that. The important thing about this amendment is it says that there needs to be a review, and the timing of that review has been extended to 3 years to allow time for the current Act to go through and be enabled. The current Act is a fairly modest Act. It shouldn't take that long to actually get it through. And the other thing is that Mark MacDonald, I think, is wrong, and he's slightly misleading us, because it says it making a recommendation as to whether learning disabilities should continue to be within the meaning of the meaning of mental disorder. It doesn't presume to say that that will not be the case or be the case. It allows for the discussion and it allows for that review to be set up. The government has been on a journey on this. In the initial stages, they said no. There's going to...
Mark MacDonald.
I take the point that Dr. Simpson is making. My point was not around what the conclusions of the review would be. It would be about how those conclusions were then enacted. And by enacting via regulations as opposed to, for example, primary legislation, it reduces the opportunity for parliamentary scrutiny and debate. That was the point that I was making in my comments on the amendment, not about presupposing the conclusions of the review.
Dr. Simpson.
Of course, if the government felt that it was necessary, they could come back at that point with primary legislation, but this allows a mechanism which might be simpler to simply remove it if there is a degree of unanimity at that particular point in time. I think the other point is this, as Malcolm Chisholm said, if this is something that had just come up very recently, then I think the government's objections might be valid, but it has been something which has been on the cards since the Milan Committee itself sat. As I said, the government has been on a journey on this. They began by saying no, they then by saying, well, it would be extremely complex, and they are right, of course, because we need to look at the 1995 Act, the 2000 Act, the 2003 Act, and the 2007 Act. So it is important that we get this right in terms of protecting people with learning disability. But nevertheless, the next step is, I think, for the government, having now committed itself to a review, which I understand they've done, and I'm sure the government will do so again. I would invite the government today, if they wish to push through opposition to this amendment, to give us some sort of idea of the timetable under which this review would be established. Because if they don't do that, then I think we will look at whether we can take them seriously in terms of moving this forward. I think this is a modest amendment, and I support the amendment in the name of Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Dr. Nanette Milne.
I mean, I also support this amendment. I accept that the Minister has a commitment to this review, but a review was first proposed, as Dr. Simpson said, by the Milan Committee as far back as 2001, and it was again recommended by McManus in 2009. And I understand the frustration that this hasn't yet happened. I think Jackie Bailey's suggestion of a three-year gap between now and the review being done is very reasonable. And I won't say any more, but I do very much support this amendment.
Thank you very much. And I now call on the Minister.
Thank you very much, President Officer. Can I say at the outset, I very much appreciate the work that's been done by Richard Simpson, Jackie Bailey on this issue at stage two, and for the constructive meeting which we had following the stage two process. I recognise also that a number of people and organisations have raised issues about the inclusion of not just learning disability but also autistic spectrum disorders under the Mental Health Act. Indeed, I myself met with People First and heard directly from them their perspective on this matter, and I do understand their frustration that there hasn't been a review undertaken thus far. It is for this reason that I have already committed to carrying out a review on the inclusion of learning disability and autistic spectrum disorders under the Mental Health Act. I am listening to the views of those with learning disability. I put that commitment on the record in the Scottish Government's response to the Stage 1 report, and can I say it was a rather stronger response than the one that, from the Scottish Executive in 2001 that Malcolm Chisholm alluded to. I've committed to the review. I put it on record again in the Stage 2 debate, and I'm putting it on record again now. This Government will undertake that review. There are no objections from this administration to moving forward with the review. We are committed to doing so. I think Richard Simpson's point about our seriousness of intent about how quickly we can establish this review is a fair one. My intention is to start the process as soon as possible, and indeed, essentially, we have already begun that process. My officials have already started to discuss with partners how that will happen, and I will share information with the Health and Sport Committee about progress as this develops. As Mark MacDonald said, there is not anything in the main that there is to disagree with in the general thrust of what Jackie Bailey has said in moving her amendment. I think it's just about getting the way forward right. I do not believe it's sensible to include the requirement for a timescale for completion of the review in the face of this legislation. The review must be genuinely participative and must not start with a predetermined outcome or process. This requires a flexible approach which can adjust to the views of those who are involved. I understand the desire for a clear timescale, not just for beginning the process, which hopefully I have given some clear indication about, but also for completion. I'm very clear that a review will happen. I want to start as soon as possible, and I believe that the timescale of three years from Royal Assent as set out in the amendment is a reasonable aim. However, I do not want to place an artificial time limit on this review. I do not want to prejudge where this review will go. It is important that this is a genuinely participative review, allowing all voices an opportunity to influence the process and to be heard, and that should be what determines how long the review takes. But my clear commitment is for it to be completed as quickly as is possible. I think more substantially, though, than on the just the timings issue, and I think this is where the amendment doesn't just call for a review, President, I have particular concerns in relation to the requirements of subsection 5, which sets out what must be done if ministers recommend in the required report that learning disabilities should not continue to be within the meaning of mental disorder. In these circumstances, ministers would have to make provision by regulations for the removal of learning disability from the meaning of mental disorder. I think Mr MacDonald has reasonably set out the concerns that this may not allow for a change to be made through a bill which would allow for far more scrutiny and engagement in relation to this major change. But I think even more crucially, it is not clear to me that this would allow for any new system to ensure the support and protection for those with learning disability as exists in the 2003 Act. I think there was common recognition of the importance of doing that at Stage 2, and I think both Ms Bailey and Dr Simpson have set that out. Again, the approach also seeks to require ministers to legislate when their powers to do so are subject to parliamentary approval, while ministers could lay a draft regulation before Parliament to implement the recommendations of the reports out with our powers to ensure that they are made. That is rightly the prerogative of Parliament as a whole. It would appear to me to be an attempt to bind Parliament to legislate in a particular way in future just because ministers have published a report containing recommendations to that effect. I'm not sure that that is what Jackie Bailey intends. Presiding Officer, I think we can all agree that this is an important issue, and that it is important that the whole range of views are heard. Those who have been making the case that learning disability and autism should not be included, and those that would make the case for the benefit of the protection, safeguards and access that the legislation provides. I have committed to a review which would achieve that aim. That's my serious and determined commitment. I would urge Jackie Bailey not to press an amendment, and if she does, that members do not support it.
Many thanks. I now call on Jackie Bailey.
I just say to the Minister, my intentions are always honourable. We've had the Milan Committee in 2001. Nothing happened. We had the McManus Review in 2009 under this government. Nothing happened. I am not questioning the Minister's personal commitment to this, but to be frank, and I say this to Mark MacDonald as well, we've had commitments before. We've waited 14 years. This amendment means it will happen and cannot ever be put on the back burner. Can I also say to the Minister, give me a second. Can I also say to the Minister, I would anticipate there would be significant debate and engagement round about the review. You have yourself promised that it would be an inclusive process, and I believe you. But you know, there are opportunities open to this Parliament. If you have a problem with the suggestion of regulation, it is the case that this Parliament can use a super affirmative procedure with additional time for consultation and scrutiny. And committees of this Parliament have been challenging of government in the past. But Richard Simpson's absolutely right. This Scottish Government could bring forward a bill that would amend that power. You could put it in primary legislation if you chose to do so. So please, let's not dance on the head of a pin, because this is a reasonable and modest amendment. It reflects what the Minister has previously said to me was his concern. There is no sensible reason that I can see for not supporting this. And what I've heard around the Chamber is agreement about the principle of what we're doing and actually the need for a review. So I really just genuinely don't understand, therefore, why you won't logically have that review and put it in legislation. It recognises this amendment, the complexity of the issue. It does not presuppose the outcome. It wouldn't be appropriate to do so. People with learning disabilities have been more than patient, presiding officer. This Parliament, this Government, should do the right thing and act now. And I urge members to support the amendment, which I will be pressing.
I'd take your intervention.
I don't have you given
I'll yet? Take your intervention, yes.
I wasn't clear that Ms Bailey was giving way to me. Would she recognise that, in fact, we have begun this process? We've done that because it is a serious intention. Would she accept that?
Presiding officer, it is usually for the member to accept an intervention, but I bow to your judgment. Let me just say, people have started the process before. Minister after minister has actually said, we will do this. Can I just say to the presiding officer, the minister, in reflecting one of his concerns to me, said there wasn't time for civil servants to do it just now because they would need to get on with the enactment of the bill. That hasn't changed, and therefore, whilst he may have started the process, it is the finish of that process that people care about. So I intend, as I said before, to press my amendment because it's the right thing to do.
Many thanks. And so the question is that Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will therefore be a division, and this will be a 1-minute division. Please vote now. Thanks. The result of the vote on Amendment number 1 is yes 52, no 59. There were no abstentions, and the amendment is therefore not agreed. Now, move to Group 9. We call Amendment 35 in the name of Dr. Richard Simpson. Dr. Simpson to speak to and move Amendment 35, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. At stage 2, Adam Ingram moved Amendment 109, which specified a significant amount of information which would be required to be collected and collated and analysed by the Mental Welfare Commission. The Minister, in his response, felt that the requirements in that amendment were far too onerous. This Amendment 35 is simply a requirement for the Scottish Ministers to direct in regulation as they see fit, after consultation, the nature and circumstances in which information should be collected, collated by the Mental Welfare Commission. The issue I accept has been partially covered with a very helpful amendment to 29, which actually gives us the principle that the Minister is prepared to allow situations which the Mental Welfare Commission can command that information from health boards, state hospitals and local authorities. But that was only in relation to advocacy services. There could be no doubt that the current system is dysfunctional. There requires to be effective collection and analysis of data on suicides, assaults, adverse incidents and on the use of restraint, just to give some examples of things within the mental health system which we need to actually have proper data on. The Scottish Information Commissioner has been critical of at least one health board's recording of significant adverse events within the mental health system. What we're proposing here is a much broader approach, but nevertheless one in which the Minister himself or his successor can determine just how much information should be collected and collated and how it should be done. I move the amendment.
Thank you very much. Now move to the Minister.
It's been useful to hear Richard Simpson's explanation for this amendment. Members will note that in its briefing on stage three, the Commission has set out the extensive range of information that it publishes and has noted that it would be happy to consider any request by ministers to produce further statistical information. I know that the Mental Welfare Commission is keen to do more to make the statistical information it collects useful and is already in discussions with the Information Services Division of NHS National Services Scotland and others about how to do this. Notwithstanding all of that, I accept the desire for information to be requested of the Commission through regulations which have first been consulted upon rather than via ministerial direction. I'm happy on that basis to accept the amendment. However, it is important that any subsequent regulations do not cause undue or disproportionate burden or bureaucracy, and I will work to ensure that this is not the case, but I am happy to accept Richard Simpson's amendment.
Many thanks, Dr. Simpson.
Nothing to add.
Many thanks. And so the question is that Amendment 35 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are. Many thanks. And that takes us to Group 10. Call Amendment 36 in the name of Dr. Richard Simpson. Dr. Simpson to move and speak to Amendment 36, please.
This covers the questions of deaths and detention. And the amendment requires a review of the arrangements for investigating deaths in detention or otherwise in hospital for the treatment of a mental disorder. The Justice Committee is currently considering the Fatal Accident Inquiries Bill, but that people detained under the mental health regulation or being voluntarily treated in a mental hospital for mental disorders may not be actually part of that forthcoming legislation. It's clear that around half the deaths, of patients whilst receiving treatment may be due to natural causes, so a blanket approach to insist on an FAI for every death would not be appropriate. However, Sam H, along with the Scottish Human Rights Commission and the Mental Welfare Commission, are concerned that the current system may lead to some individuals falling through the gaps. As such, they are of the view that arrangements for investigating the deaths of mental health patients needs to be addressed. Currently, the reports of the Mental Welfare Commission are mainly statistical, and whilst that is interesting, it is not sufficient. If we look at the last report of the 78 deaths, in 5 cases there was no information. So once again, we're not getting the information from the health boards that are absolutely necessary to even understanding the statistical progress of these issues. 38 were deemed as natural deaths, but we've no idea as to whether these were premature. One of the big issues in relation to mental illness is the fact that people with mental illness, particularly severe and enduring mental illness, are dying much younger. And therefore, actually understanding their death, even if it's apparently from natural causes and from a physical condition, is important. There is a need to ensure that as for the Health Environment Inspectorate and the Health Improvement Scotland's report on the elderly, there are transparent assurances that the board will in future take such action as may be required to improve prevention of suicide or other deaths, which may be, and I stress, may be preventable. Families want to know that any lessons that could be learned are learned. In the present circumstances, I don't believe that is the case, and I hope that the Minister will now support this amendment, as he did in the last one, which was very welcome.
Many thanks, Minister.
I thank Richard Simpson for his continuing work on this issue and again for the constructive meeting we had following stage two to discuss this matter. As I said at stage two, I believe that improvements should be made to how deaths in detention are reviewed to ensure that the process is effective and timely, that it supports learning and that the reviews are of a consistent quality. Members will be aware of the briefing from the Mental Welfare Commission on this issue. The Commission has noted that it agrees that the arrangements for investigating deaths need streamlining and set out a proposed approach that includes notification of all deaths of patients subject to compulsion to the Fiscal and Mental Welfare Commission, a review by the Commission of all such deaths to determine if more detailed investigation is required, in appropriate cases a more formal review building on Health Improvement Scotland guidance into adverse events investigation, and a protocol between the Commission and the Crown Office to ensure joint working in the context of the Lord Advocate's responsibilities for the investigation of deaths. My officials have already started to explore with the Mental Welfare Commission how we can bring together a working group to develop a streamlined and effective approach to reviewing deaths in detention. It is important this is focused on ensuring that services are able to learn from reviews that are carried out and improve services so they are more effective and safer. The approach should also ensure that relatives or carers are able to participate fully in the process. I do believe that the work underway is an effective way of dealing with this issue, and I do not consider there is a need for ministers to be compelled to undertake a review given we have given undertaking to do so. However, I do not consider that to be adverse consequences of the amendment, so I am happy to support it.
Thanks, Dr. Simpson. Anything further to add?
To add.
Many thanks. And so the question is that Amendment 36 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. Many thanks. Call Amendment 37 in the name of Dr. Nanette Milne. Dr. Milne, to move or not move? Many thanks. And so the question is that Amendment 37 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not. There will therefore be a division, and I think this will be a 1 minute division. Please vote now. Seconds. Many thanks. The result of the vote on Amendment number 37 is yes 45, no 62. There were no abstentions and the amendment is therefore not agreed. Now move to Group 11 and call Amendment 38 in the name of Dr. Richard Simpson. Dr. Simpson, to move and speak to Amendment 38, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This amendment is brought forward by the Law Society, with whom I've had discussions, and it would add a new section to Part 1 of the Bill, ensuring that recorded matters under Section 64 of the Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act 2003 are included, firstly, in the orders which the Tribunal may make when confirming the determination or variation a compulsion order in respect of a patient. Also, interim extension of orders under Section 149 or 158, and orders made under Section 193 of the Mental Health Act. It also amends the meaning of modifying in relation to both relevant compulsion orders and compulsion and restriction orders under that Act, and to include instances where recorded matters are specified. The reason for this amendment, the Law Society have indicated, is that the Act does set out the definition of recorded matter, but they can specify recorded matter when making a compulsory treatment order and also when reviewing a compulsory treatment order. In essence, a recorded matter is regarded as an essential element of the patient's care and treatment. If a recorded matter is not provided, the registered medical officer must refer the matter to the tribunal under Section 96. And this reflects one of the Milan principles, that of reciprocity. Recorded matters are a means of ensuring the patients get essential elements of care and treatment which they require and can be used to secure care and treatment which might not otherwise be provided. This is a significant benefit to some patients, but Currently, recorded matters can only be specified in compulsory treatment cases. They cannot be specified in cases where the patient is under a compulsion order or a compulsion order and a restriction order. And the view of the Law Society is that such patients would benefit from the inclusion of recorded matter provisions. Compulsory treatment orders are civil orders, whereas compulsion orders and compulsion orders and restriction orders are criminal justice orders. All patients should have the right to obtain the essential treatment which they require, regardless of their route into the mental health care and treatment scheme. And I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. Now call the Minister.
Thank you, President Officer, and again can I thank Richard Simpson for lodging this amendment. As I noted at stage two, I am confident the existing provisions work well for patients who are subject to a compulsion order or subject to a compulsion order with a restriction order. Although I am not opposed in principle to introducing recorded matters to such orders, I am not convinced that it should be done in a different way to how the system works for compulsory treatment orders. The amendment proposed would lead to a different mechanism for compulsion orders or compulsion orders with restriction orders. I am concerned that there could be confusion from operating two similar but different systems, and this could add unnecessary complexity. It also omits an equivalent provision to Section 96 of the Act to provide for allowing the responsible medical officer to make a reference to the tribunal where a recorded matter has not been complied with. This requires the responsible medical officer to consult with the relevant parties, such as the mental health officer, to find out why a recorded matter is not being provided and to bring this to the attention of the tribunal. It means that the responsible medical officer will submit the original and most up-to-date care plans to the tribunal. It allows the tribunal to take the views of the patient and others, and for the tribunal to make a decision whether to vary the recorded matters or other compulsory matters in the order, including on an interim basis. This amendment therefore omits to extend an important part of the existing recorded matters provision for compulsory treatment order to the other orders, which ensures that any recorded matters not being provided is brought promptly to the attention of the tribunal, and which allows the tribunal to revise the order accordingly if needed. On that basis, I would urge Dr Simpson not to press his amendment.
Dr Simpson, can I invite you to wind up and indicate if you intend to press or withdraw?
Yes, I think I shall still press the amendment. I think that it is important that this is extended to those with compulsion and compulsion restriction orders. And I think that this amendment does that, although I do hear what the Minister is saying, that he disagrees with that. But I think the Law Society, who have their own experts in this regard, have looked at this matter very carefully, and therefore I wish to proceed with this amendment.
Many thanks. The question then is that Amendment 38 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division. This is a 1 minute division. Please vote now. The result of the vote on amendment number 38 is yes 49, no 58. There were no abstentions and the amendment is therefore not agreed to. We now move to group 12, definition of compulsion orders, and I call amendment 22 in the name of the Minister in a group on its own, and I ask the Minister to move and speak to the amendment, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The 2003 Act contains a range of provisions relating to compulsion orders. This is a disposal open to the criminal courts under the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act 1995 in respect of a person with a mental disorder following a trial or examination of facts in connection with an offence punishable by imprisonment. Section 329 defines compulsion order for the purposes of the 2003 Act as an order made under Section 57A of the 1995 Act. Section 307 of the 1995 Act defines it as an order having the meaning given in Section 57A. While the definitions deliver a similar result, they are expressed in different terms to each other. It is worth probably recapping on when a compulsion order can be made. A compulsion order can be made in three situations: where the person has been convicted of the offence, where the person has been acquitted of the offence on grounds of lack of criminal responsibility by reason of mental disorder, or where the person is unfit for trial and has been found at an examination of facts to have committed the acts constituting the offence. Section 57A of the 1995 Act makes provision allowing the court to make a compulsion order following conviction, as well as provision about what a compulsion order is and what measures it can authorise. Section 57.2A makes provision allowing the court to make a compulsion order following an acquittal or examination of facts, and subsection 4 of that section applies subsections 2 to 16 of section 57A for the purposes of that order. It is understood in practice that orders made under either of section 57.2A or 57A.2 are covered by the current definitions. However, the user of the legislation is required to read section 57.2A through the prism of the application of much of section 57A to section 57.2A by virtue of section 57.4 in order to arrive at that understanding. We believe, and hopefully that is clear why, we believe that it would aid users of the legislation if we were able to recast these definitions so as to provide for a clear, accessible and consistent definition across both of the 1995 Act and the 2003 Act. The best way of achieving this would be to refer in each of the 1995 Act and the 2003 Act specifically to an order made under either section 57.2A or 57.2 of the 1995 Act. These amendments provide for that clarification and make a consequential change to section 1.6, and I move amendment 22.
Many thanks, Minister. Since no other member has requested to speak, do you feel the need to wind up on this
section?
Indeed,
no.
In which case, the question is, amendment 22 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. We now turn to Group 13, referral to the High Court, and I call Amendment 40 in the name of Dr Richard Simpson in a group on its own, and I ask Dr Simpson to move and speak to Amendment 40, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The first piece of legislation that was passed in our Parliament in 1999, and one with which I was personally involved, was to tackle a situation arising from an appeal made under the European Convention on Human Rights by Noel Ruddle against his detention in a state hospital following serious offences. The Mental Health, Public Safety and Appeals Scotland Act 1999 introduced the serious harm test, under which patients who were convicted on indictment or complaint and subject to special restrictions by the court could be subject to indefinite hospital detention if a mental disorder was present and they were considered to pose a risk of serious harm to the public, irrespective of the appropriateness of the order or the treatability of the subject. The legislative provisions of the 1999 Act were subsequently extended in the Mental Health Care and Treatment Act Scotland 2003 and was to apply to all restricted patients in Scotland, who number about 250. Because of these provisions, there remained a small number of patients who have become stuck in the forensic mental health system, but who have been reclassified in terms of their diagnosis as either having no diagnosis or personality disorder or learning disability. The Minister's arguments against my amendment at stage two were twofold. First, that the Mental Health Act covered personality disorder, and of course that is correct, and that in some way the forensic psychiatrists were seeking to change this. This is the forensic psychiatrists who have backed this particular amendment. That view is quite wrong. They are not seeking to change the incorporation of personality disorder into the 2003 Act. That would indeed be a fundamental change and is not the intention of this amendment, nor will the amendment as written deliver such a change. The Minister's second argument was that the amendment to the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act 1995, whereby the time period for an interim compulsion order was extended from 6 months to 12 months, would ensure that a full and rigorous assessment of the offender's mental disorder was undertaken before the final disposal is made. Again, I concur. But he then went on to say it is very unlikely that an offender would be misdiagnosed in those circumstances, making it less likely, not unlikely, but less likely, now that a patient would receive a hospital disposal from the court that would create the scenario that I was putting forward. Again, he is correct. The numbers will be small. Most psychoses, if severe and enduring, will be evident within a year. But for every patient who at the time of the offence had an acute psychosis due to, for example, drugs or alcohol misuse, which did not resolve until that year had expired, and the disposal was then found to be inappropriate, since the diagnosis might only be a personality disorder or learning disability, the nature of which would be better managed in a prison, then without this amendment, we will continue to confine patients unnecessarily and, I may add, in the context of current austerity, very expensively in a mental hospital rather than a prison. Can this happen? Yes, it can. The mechanism for appeal is cumbersome, but was employed. This scarce resource was employed in the case of Alexander Reed. In his case, the Court of Criminal Appeal recognised that the change in diagnostic category could be considered as new evidence, and it allowed for a fresh disposal in his case, which allowed Mr. Reed to transfer to prison, which is what he wanted to do. The process for raising his appeal took several years. An alternative approach to that, to the problem that is raised by cases such as that of Noel Ruddle, is that there should be some mechanism by which the appropriateness of the sentence can be reconsidered for the admittedly very small number of patients whose diagnostic category has changed and whose detention in psychiatric hospital is consequently inappropriate. Not to act will mean either continued substantial excess cost, and I'm told that this amounts to some £200,000 annually per patient, and also to the inappropriate detention against which others would seek redress in the same manner as Mr. Reed did successfully. The whole approach in Scotland to personality disorder defenders was considered by a working group on the services for people with personality disorder, chaired by Professor Thompson, which reported as long ago as 2005. That report recommended that the Scottish Government consider whether a mechanism should be created to refer such cases to the Scottish Criminal Cases Review Commission for consideration. That view was re-articulated in 2011 when the Forensic Network gave evidence to the Commission on Women Offenders, chaired by the Right Honourable Dame Eilish Angelini. Amendment 40 revises my previous amendment of 113 from the 113 submitted at stage 2 to make the group to whom this would apply much more clear. This would now apply only to those with a compulsion and restriction order. The Faculty of Forensic Psychiatry believes that individuals who are offenders with only personality disorders or learning disability are far better supported and managed within the prison system rather than the mental health system. I move the amendment in my name.
Many thanks, and I call the Minister.
Thank you, President Officer. This amendment is similar to the one lodged by Dr. Simpson at stage 2. The only difference is that it now is proposed to apply only to patients subject to a compulsion or with a restriction order, whereas the stage 2 version would have also applied to patients subject to only a compulsion order. I resisted the amendment then and remain of the view, notwithstanding the narrowing of the provision to apply to a smaller subset of patients, that this is a major issue and, given the implications for the criminal justice system, not one that we should sensibly consider without thorough consultation, particularly in light of potential additional risks to the public. Let me run through the reasons for my view in more detail. The amendment proposes new powers for the tribunal and courts that would revisit the decision of the court in its original sentencing and disposal. It also opens up what can be very complex, competing clinical opinions about diagnosis. I understand that this is designed to address concerns among some psychiatrists that patients who are diagnosed or indeed misdiagnosed as having a mental illness or learning disability are made subject to compulsion or with a restriction order on that basis may later be diagnosed as having only a personality disorder, which, had the court had full medical evidence based on that diagnosis, may, I should emphasise, have resulted in a prison sentence rather than a mental health disposal. Yet, it once in the hospital system, because the patient continues to satisfy the test for a compulsion order and restriction order due to the risk of serious harm that they pose, they cannot be released. It appears to me that this proposal would result in a significant shift in how mentally disordered persons are dealt with by the criminal justice system and indeed by the health service after conviction. The present position in the 2003 Act is quite clearly that a patient who meets the conditions for a mental health disposal and requires to be detained may, in many cases, most appropriately be detained in hospital rather than in prison. As Dr. Simpson alluded to, an amendment to the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act 1995 extended the time period for an interim compulsion order from 6 months to 12 months to ensure that a full and rigorous assessment of the offender's mental disorder is undertaken before the final disposal is made. In these circumstances, it is very unlikely that an offender would be misdiagnosed, so it is much, much less likely a patient would receive a hospital disposal from the court that could create this scenario. Now, all patients subject to compulsion orders and restriction orders have the right to apply to the tribunal and for the orders to be reviewed periodically. In addition, there is already a means for the patient to have their case considered on appeal. The same appeal route is indeed used for those offenders who have received a prison sentence who argue they should have received a hospital disposal. As I said at stage two, the amendment is well intentioned. However, it is a major issue with significant implications for the criminal justice system. It is not one I believe that we should be considering without thorough consultation. I would urge Dr. Simpson not to press his amendment, and if he does, I would strongly urge members not to vote for the amendment.
Many thanks, Dr. Simpson. Can I invite you to wind up and indicate if you intend to press or withdraw?
I think the most important thing to say is that the tribunal may refer this matter to the High Court. There's no compulsion upon the medical tribunal to do so, but it does mean that the medical tribunal would consider the matter, and that's an appropriate locus for an appeal against the previous diagnosis to be actually argued out with expert people appearing in front of the tribunal. The other thing is that the Minister, on the one hand, is saying that this would be a major change in the criminal procedures, and on the other hand, is saying that it's very unlikely that anyone would actually come forward with this because of the change to the Criminal Procedures Act. Those two things seem to me to be quite illogical, in fact, completely opposed to each other. So I fail to understand why he opposes this measure, which will simplify matters, could reduce costs in a small number of patients. I'm told that it might apply to no more than half a dozen. If it is half a dozen patients, Minister, that is still £1.2 million of money that is being spent inappropriately at the moment, retaining people in state hospital when in fact they would be better managed within the prison system. The forensic psychiatry faculty and the prison service have had extensive discussions since the report in 2005, and they believe, both sides believe, that personality disorders in the absence of a mental illness, of another severe and enduring mental illness, should in fact be managed within the prison system. Those prisoners believe that as well, but they have no easy mechanism to follow this at the moment. This amendment will provide that mechanism, and I believe it has been carefully thought out and therefore should be applied in order to both save us money and improve the situation for those limited number of patients. I move the amendment in my name.
Question is that amendment 40 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed.
1 minute.
1 minute division. Please vote now. The result of the vote on amendment number 40 is a yes 49, no 59. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. That brings us to group 14, review of criminal behaviour, and I call amendment number 39 in the name of Dr. Richard Simpson in a group on its own, and I ask Dr. Simpson to move and speak to amendment 39, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Out of the last 137 homicides committed by those with mental illness in the last 10 years in Scotland, only two appear to have been the subject of published reports by the Mental Welfare Commission, and few seem to have been the subject of adverse incident reviews by boards. When this is compared to the situation in England over the same period, there were 576 homicides and 321 reviews. These English reviews suggest to some that some 25 to 35% of homicides could have been prevented with different actions. It is very important that we recognise and put on record that murder or culpable homicide, or indeed violence by persons suffering from a mental illness, is a rare occurrence. But the intention of Amendment 39 to the 1995 Criminal Procedures Act is to provide in primary legislation clarity, consistency and accountability about reviewing, reporting and taking appropriate action where lessons can be learned on offences as specified in 63A section 16 of my amendment, involving a person suffering from a mental illness known to the mental health services. This would apply to murder, culpable homicide and such other offences as the Minister may by regulation prescribe. The three purposes of this amendment are, firstly, that we should learn lessons so that in future those with mental health problems can, as far as possible, be protected and prevented from committing such offences. Secondly, to ensure that the families of the victims and the person affected, if they survive, can be sure that all that can be done to prevent a recurrence will be done. And thirdly, so that the public can have confidence in the NHS. At present, colleagues, we have a dysfunctional system of reporting and review. It involves decisions by multiple different organisations, or none if they choose not to act. This includes the Procurator Fiscal, the UK Confidential Inquiry Reports into Homicide and Suicide, the Health Board, the Mental Welfare Commission, who can certainly act if they believe there's a deficiency of care, but how do they know if the case hasn't been reported to them? Other organisations, which may or may not have a role, are Health Improvement Scotland, and indeed the health and safety at work, and finally, the Minister who could order a review. This issue came up before me because of concerns from the 100 Families organisation, an organisation which draws together information and provides mutual support for families affected by such offences. My purpose in moving these amendments is to ensure that under 63A, 2A and B, that if charged, the Procurator Fiscal will inform both the Board and the Mental Welfare Commission. Now, in the Stage 2, the Minister expressed concerns that individuals might be found not guilty or found incapable of pleading. But experience reported by the 100 Families organisation is that in almost every case there is no attempt to hide and the offence is almost always admitted. And as you will see in my amendment, which I have adjusted to take account of the Minister's concerns, the perpetrator has the opportunity to give permission, and the Minister should only then proceed if, when that, that is not actually given, if they feel it's in the public interest. This is not about guilt or innocence. That's a matter for the justice system. This is about learning lessons and preventing future possible incidents. If a person with a severe mental illness is involved and known to the service, usually in the last 6 months, the Board would be obliged to make inquiries under 63A, 3A, B and C and prepare and publish a report and action plan. Now, the Minister also expressed concern that the confidentiality of the patient would be infringed, and I've addressed that again by ensuring that, again, unless the person consents or it's in the public interest, their name should be redacted. And the same restriction applies to the mental welfare reports, which I believe should be placed before Parliament as a collation of the reports from the health boards. Those affected by these rare offences have a right to know that all that can be done will be done to prevent a recurrence. I am aware that of the two further concerns about my proposal. Firstly, the timing as to how long ago should the mental health services have been involved to require them to conduct an inquiry and produce a report. Instead of having a fixed time limit or no time limit, I have now allowed the Minister to determine this in regulations if the amendment is accepted. Secondly, there is a concern that a review by the Board would have cut across the justice process. I believe that this is nonsense. This is not whether or not the offence was committed or what action in law is appropriate. It is about a reviewing care and treatment of the person charged. Finally, I very much welcome the ongoing discussions between the Mental Welfare Commission, the Health Improvement Scotland and the health boards. But will the outcome of their discussions be enshrined in law or regulations? It will not. We have had a permissive system now for over a decade, which is not good, and it is enough time for us to make sure now that this law be made clear. I move Amendment 39.
Thank you, and I now call the Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I thank Richard Simpson for his continuing work on this issue. I know that he has been working particularly closely with victims' organisations. The amendment Dr Simpson has lodged is similar to the one he lodged at Stage 2, and I note that he has sought to address some of the issues which that amendment had, notably addressing concerns relating to confidentiality and restricting the scope of people being treated in the 6 months before being charged with an offence. However, I still have fundamental concerns in relation to a review being triggered upon a person being charged with an offence prior to any conviction. I am concerned that this would cut across the prosecution system, whose independence is guaranteed by the Scotland Act 1998 and the circumstances required for a fair trial. I cannot accept investigations which run parallel to what the fiscal and police are doing, especially if it involves publication of findings which could potentially interfere with that process. I do not believe that this is a nonsense. I believe it is a serious concern. I do, however, agree that a more streamlined system is needed, which ensures that lessons are learned and shared across the system, and which provides comfort and reassurance to families in those tragic cases. Members will be aware of the briefing by the Mental Welfare Commission for this stage, which covers this issue. The Commission already has a power under Section 11 of the 2003 Act to investigate cases of deficiency of care. It has from time to time investigated homicides by patients under this power. The Commission has proposed that they, working with Healthcare Improvement Scotland, should build on existing systems to ensure that all cases are reviewed appropriately. In doing so, they would consult with key stakeholders such as the Forensic Division of the Royal College and, of course, 100 families. The Commission has noted that it will be able to share an outline proposal with interested parties in the summer. In light of the work already underway and the significant concerns I have with this amendment, I would urge Dr Simpson not to press his amendment.
Thank you, Dr Simpson. Can you wind up and indicate if you intend to press or withdraw?
Briefly, Deputy Presiding Officer, the issue of being charged and cutting across the justice issue, it is perfectly possible for the report and the review to be undertaken, but for the report not to be published until the fiscal or court determine the outcome. And in that case, if it is undertaken on a private basis, it will not in fact interfere with the public concerns about the court cases proceeding. So on that basis, I reject the Minister's concerns in that regard. I do welcome the fact that the Minister is proceeding with discussions with the various interested bodies to sort out what is actually accepted by all, including the Mental Welfare Commission, as being a dysfunctional system. But I simply do not believe that we do have regulators in Scotland generally that have sufficient teeth to ensure that all cases are properly investigated. There is no great evidence that under the permissive system that we've had this has occurred, and I do not have the confidence of believing that without regulation, which the Minister will determine what those regulations are, subject to Parliament's approval, that without regulation we could be sitting here in another 5 or 6 years debating exactly the same topic in exactly the same way, even with the best will in the world and new protocols being determined. I wish to move the amendment to my name.
The Member has pressed amendment. The question is that Amendment 39 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division. This will be a 1 minute division. Please vote now. The result of the vote on Amendment No. 39 is yes 50, No, 59. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. That brings us to Group 15, Victim Notification Scheme, and I call Amendment 41 in the name of the Minister. Group with Amendments 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47 and 48. And I ask the Minister to move Amendment 41 and speak to all of the amendments in the group, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. These amendments are all to Part 3 of the Bill, which introduces the Statutory Notification and Representation Scheme for victims of offenders who are mentally disordered and, as a result, subject to certain orders. The intention is to develop a scheme that, as closely as possible, resembles the scheme available to victims under the Criminal Justice Act 2003. Amendments 42, 43, 45, 47 make provision for providing information to victims when a tribunal has made a decision to revoke a patient's restriction order, but the decision is successfully appealed and overturned. Victims can choose to join the victim notification scheme. A victim can also opt into the victim representation scheme, that is to make representations to the mental health tribunal. In order to opt into the representation scheme, the victim must also opt into the notification scheme. If a victim has opted into the notification scheme but not the representation scheme, he or she will receive a notification only when the position of the restricted patient changes, and that change is one covered by the scheme. Matters are, however, complicated by the possibility of an appeal against the tribunal's revocation of a compulsion order or restriction order. They are further complicated by the fact that under Section 323 of the 2003 Mental Health Act, the court can make an order rendering the tribunal's decision to revoke the order ineffectual until an appeal against it has been finally determined. The proposed amendments provide for a range of scenarios under these circumstances. Under the circumstance where a victim has chosen not to join the representation scheme, the decision of the tribunal is appealed and the court makes the Section 323 order to suspend the decision of the tribunal pending determination of the appeal. The victim will only be notified if and when the order is revoked. This is once the appeal process is complete and the outcome is that the order is revoked. This is on the basis that there has not been a material change to the position of the patient. The compulsion order or restriction orders remain in place until the order is revoked at the end of the appeal process. Under the circumstances where a victim has chosen not to join the representation scheme and the decision of the tribunal is appealed, but the court does not make a Section 323 order to suspend the decision pending the determination of the appeal, the victim will be notified and kept informed of the progress of the appeal. This is on the basis that there has been a material change to the position of the patient, that is, the restriction order or compulsion order has been revoked. Where a victim has chosen to join the representation scheme, the bill provides the victim will be told of the outcome of the tribunal's decision. If that decision is appealed, the victim will get information that the decision has been appealed and the progress and outcome of that appeal, whether the court makes a Section 323 order or not. The bill provides for ministers to give a victim an opportunity to make representations about varying conditions imposed on the patient, a way which may have an effect on the victim or members of the victim's family. Amendments 41, 44, 46 and 48 are intended to ensure that the provisions are workable in practice. At stage two, I introduced an amendment on the sort of information that may be provided to a victim about a patient covering conditions imposing restrictions and the things that the patient may do after his or her conditional discharge. I indicate that in practice this will commonly be restrictions as to where the patient is prohibited from going in persons with whom the patient may not have contact. Having considered further how this would work in practice, I recognise that there could be circumstances where the officials operating the scheme may not know which conditions could affect the victim or a member of the victim's family. If ministers fail to see the victim's representations under these circumstances, they would unwittingly be in breach of their statutory duty. These amendments take account of that, but still ensure the rights of the victim to make representations on specific conditions. I move Amendment 41.
Many thanks, Minister. Another member has requested to speak. Do you wish to wind up? Thank you. The question then is that Amendment 41 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. I now call Amendments 42, 43, 44, 45, 46, 47, 48 and 23, all in the name of the Minister and all previously debated, and I invite the Minister to move Amendments 42 to 48 and 23 on block.
It moved, President Officer.
Thank you. Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 42 to 48 and 23? No member has objected. The question then is that Amendments 42 to 48 and 23 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. And that ends consideration of amendments. The next item of business is a debate on motion number 13599 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on the Mental Health Scotland Bill. Could I ask members who are leaving the chamber to please do so quickly and quietly? And could I invite members who wish to speak in this debate to press the request to speak buttons now, please? calling Jamie Hepburn to speak to and move the motion. Minister, 10 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, the Mental Health Bill's overarching objective is to help people with a mental disorder to access effective treatment quickly and easily. It does so by improving the operation of the 2003 Mental Health Act and the 1985 Criminal Procedure Act, which provides fundamental protections and safeguards to people with a mental disorder. It also introduces a victim notification scheme for victims of mentally disordered offenders in a way that respects the rights of both victims and vulnerable offenders. I am very grateful for the detailed and thorough scrutiny which the Health and Sport Committee has given to the bill at stages 1 and 2, which has helped ensure that we get this legislation right and continue to maximise those protections and safeguards. The bill has been significantly improved during its parliamentary passage. As a result, I'd like to record my thanks to committee members, as well as those members who are not on the committee who have engaged with the process, for the work they have done. I'd like to take a few moments to set out some of the key aspects of the bill. Presiding Officer, the 2003 Act brought in important protections, including advanced statements which help involve patients in decision-making about their treatment by allowing service users to state how they would like to be treated if they become unwell. The bill will strengthen the position of advance statements, giving service users greater confidence that their wishes will be taken into account in their treatment, and ensuring the Mental Welfare Commission has a better picture of the use of advance statements. I was very pleased to see that we supported the amendment in the name of Bob Dorris, which will help service users access support and taking up the opportunity to make a statement. We want to see advance statements used on a far wider basis. I think that's been a common theme across the committee's scrutiny of this bill. Taking these provisions together, the bill should increase use of advance statements and, through this, help more service users to have greater involvement in decisions about their treatment when they are unwell. Many service users have found the role of the named person introduced by the 2003 Act to be an important protection, giving someone they know a role to act independently to protect their interests. But I listened to the significant concerns that service users do not always want a named person, particularly as they see confidential information about the patient's medical treatment. The provisions in the bill mean that a service user will only have a named person if they want one. This is a really important step in promoting service users' rights. At the same time, we have, through amendments at stage 2, ensured that protections are in place for vulnerable service users who don't have the capacity to decide whether to appeal an order or certificate, whilst ensuring that this does not impact on their privacy or autonomy. This bill will ensure that the intention in introducing the excessive security appeal provisions in the 2003 Act and the Milan recommendations is fulfilled by extending the right of appeal against being detained in conditions of excessive security to those detained in medium secure units. That intention was to give patients in high secure and medium secure units a right to appeal detention in conditions of excessive security. What is needed now is to take the scheme provided for in 2003 and ensure it can operate effectively in the present secure state. The amendments debated today will ensure that we do that by extending the right to patients in medium secure units as quickly as possible. I look forward to discussing this further when draft regulations are considered by the committee and Parliament after recess. These are just some of the key changes in the bill which will make the 2003 Act work more effectively and enhance the experience of and protections for service users. There has been widespread support for the introduction of the victim notification scheme for victims of mentally disordered offenders. The intention is for a scheme which respects the rights of both victims and indeed vulnerable offenders, closely resembling the scheme already available to victims under the Criminal Justice Act. This scheme will be of huge benefit to victims who were not previously covered by the Criminal Justice Scheme, and it will provide them with greater reassurance when the offender begins the process of discharge from treatment. We have also recognised that mentally disordered offenders may themselves be vulnerable, and I know that was a perspective that was being expressed by the committee during its consideration of the bill at its earlier stages, and we have made sure that this is taken into account. I am very grateful to the Victim Rights Working Group, which was established, which included representatives from victim support and 100 families, for their assistance in getting this balance right. This bill
is an amending one in relation to the 2003 Act, and I am aware that some members would have liked to have seen wider issues included. This bill is not a full stop at the end of a process. I'm happy to put on record my commitment, indeed restate my commitment to certain further steps. I've heard the concerns that a number of people and organisations have raised about the inclusion of learning disability or autistic spectrum disorders under the 2003 Act, and I thank Jackie Bailey and Richard Simpson for the discussions we had on that matter. We obviously have debated the issue extensively at the amendment stage. The 2003 Act provides people with learning disabilities and autistic spectrum disorders with important protections and safeguards, and importantly, access to care and treatment. I think it's essential that in anything we seek to do, we must ensure that these protections must continue. I have committed to reviewing the inclusion of learning disability and autism under the definition of mental disorder in the 2003 Act. It is important that this is genuinely participative and is commenced with an open mind about the outcome and process. And as I set out earlier, President Officer, we have started to discuss with stakeholders how we can undertake this engagement. I hope that further demonstrates our serious intent in that regard and holding that review. A number of committee members also raised issues in relation to the role that psychologists play under the 2003 Act, following consideration of the issue by the British Psychological Society, and I'd like to thank them for their positive engagement. And again, I'd like to thank Dr. Milne for bringing forward the issue again at the amendment stage. I think it is important that we debate these issues. I suppose I've made the point, and I'll make the point again. I'm sympathetic to this issue. I just wasn't convinced of the specific provisions of the amendment. I do think it's important that we have that more widespread consultation and more widespread review of the matter. And as I noted earlier, I'm committed to looking at this alongside the wider review around learning disabilities and autism spectrum disorders. Again, that is a serious commitment to review, Presiding Officer. Amendments were lodged at both Stage 2 and Stage 3 in relation to investigating deaths of patients who are in hospital for treatment of mental illness deaths and the reporting of homicide by those being treated for a mental health condition. While I did not believe that a legislative approach was appropriate, I was of course happy to accept Amendment 36. It was always the case that I believe that further work is necessary. My officials have already started to explore with the Mental Welfare Commission how we can bring together a working group to develop a streamlined and effective approach to reviewing deaths in detention. In relation to the reporting of homicides by those being treated for a mental health condition, the Mental Welfare Commission will work, as I said earlier, with Healthcare Improvement Scotland and the Government to bring forward proposals building on current practice to ensure that all cases are reviewed appropriately. And in doing so, I recognise it's very important to consult with key stakeholders, particularly I think the Forensic Division of the Royal College of Psychiatrists and most definitely appropriately organisations such as 100 Families. I will ensure that the Health and Sport Committee is informed of developments in both of these issues, and of course I'll always be happy to take the perspective of the committee in any work we take forward. President, so this bill is part of the wider work that the Government is undertaking to improve mental health service, including funding. I announced on the earlier this year in May an additional £85 million for mental health over 5 years, beyond the £15 million over 3 years announced in November 2014 for the Mental Health Innovation Fund, £100 million in total. We will be working with NHS Scotland and its partners to ensure that we get maximum benefit from the investment, focusing on further improvement to children and adolescent mental health services to bring down waiting times, improved access to services and in particular psychological therapies, and better responses to mental health in community and primary care settings, including promoting wellbeing through physical activity and, crucially, improved patient rights. And again, I'll be happy to keep Parliament up to date with progress on these matters. In conclusion, President Officer, this bill further enhances the ability of people with a mental disorder to access effective treatment quickly and easily while maintaining and enhancing protections and safeguards. I move that the Parliament agrees that the Mental Health Bill be passed. Thank you, President Officer.
Many thanks. I now call on Jenny Mara. 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I welcome the final stage today of the Mental Health Bill. And can I also thank the people who moved amendments this afternoon? I've put all that work and consideration into the detail of this legislation, specifically the Minister himself, my colleagues Richard Simpson and Jackie Bailey. We recognise the bill, Presiding Officer, as a very important step in tackling one of the greatest public health challenges of our time. And we can reflect today on the progress we have made as a country in removing the stigma attributed to mental health and addressing the complex and varied need for support that exists with the many people who are affected. But in acknowledging the rise in awareness of mental health problems and the growing confidence people now have in coming forward to access help, we also recognise that we still have much to do to ensure that there is a proper preventative agenda in place and that we support people to overcome or better manage mental health issues. Now, this bill brings to an end a long and often technical process which implements much of the comprehensive and detailed work of Professor Jim McManus and his review team in how we help people access quick and effective treatment for mental health. The amount of work, building on Bruce Millen's review some years ago, that has gone into this bill and the level of engagement on the detail from outside groups proves what a serious and important issue this is for our Parliament and Scotland. And I think every member in this chamber would share my experience in their constituencies of the vast amount of casework we deal with on mental health issues, on access to mental health services, and the effect on our communities and families. I think for every family in Scotland on mental health. I do commend, Presiding Officer, today the Government for its early approach in the passage of the bill by listening and responding to concerns that were raised at Stage 1. I believe we have improved the legislation which will pass today with our support. But I do believe there are areas where we could have gone further, particularly on the definition of mental disorder and patients' rights. As we know, the Millen Review in 2001 recommended that there should be an expert review at an early date of the position of learning disability within mental health law. This was echoed by the McManus Review, which said again in 2009 that it is time that this is done. Now, this is supported by a number of groups, including Inclusion Scotland and Enable. And, Presiding Officer, if I can just quote from them today, Inclusion Scotland said, "We believe that evidence presented to the Health and Sport Committee raises serious questions on whether the safeguards in the 2003 Act, particularly on the role of mental health officers and the right to advocacy, are working as intended, and on whether mental health legislation is compatible with ECHR. Inclusion Scotland therefore believes that the time is right for a more comprehensive review of mental health legislation in Scotland to ensure compliance with human rights obligations and to provide specific legislation to meet the needs of people with learning disabilities or autistic spectrum disorders." Enable pointed out that 14 years after a review was first recommended in Millen, people with learning disabilities are still waiting for a review to take place. And the case has been made very ably today in this chamber by my colleagues Richard Simpson and Jackie Bailey. That would have instigated a major review of mental health services, which puts rights first. I'm going to make some progress, but thank you, Minister. A major review would have explored whether learning disability and autism should be considered a mental disorder. It would have scrutinised the human rights implications of a patient's right to refuse treatment. It would have allowed us to have a proper look at advocacy services and allowed transparent investigations into deaths in mental health units or under community treatment orders. With both reviews calling for this change, many of the mental health charities supporting it and organisations and a well-argued amendment by my colleagues, this was an opportunity to make that change that is needed. And while we are disappointed that the government failed to support this approach today, there is enough in this bill in its current form for us to support the government and welcome the passage of the bill today. Yes.
Hepburn.
I suggest we have rejected the approach that will see a review of the inclusion of learning disability and autism within the scope of the 2003 Act. That is fundamentally not the case. I have committed repeatedly now to that review. We will be undertaking that review, and on that basis, I presume she will welcome that fact.
Well, I thank the Minister for that assurance, but it is my understanding that Jackie Bailey's amendment, which I referred to, was rejected today by the Government. I would like to clarify.
Jamie Hepburn.
Farah, we had the debate around the circumstance of the amendment. It was the specifics of the amendment. We had the detailed debate. I'm happy to go over that again. In closing, it wasn't about the principle that we have the review. I've committed to the government undertaking that review. We will have that review. There were just some concerns about the specifics of Ms Bailey's amendment.
Well, I hope that the Minister, in summing up, might actually put a time frame on that review and make commitments to that. So, presiding officers, can we welcome many of the well-thought-out steps which will be implemented as a result of this bill, in advance statements and in advocacy? But we cannot leave this chamber today with a sense of a job done. In Scotland, a quarter of people will experience a diagnosable mental health problem at some point in their lives. The varied and complex nature of mental health and the slow and invisible way it can take hold of people's lives mean that we have to stay vigilant and continually look forward to improve support for mental health. Scotland has long been regarded, presiding officer, as a world leader in support for mental health, something we are rightly proud of as a parliament. But if that is to continue, we must keep building on this and ensure we are offering person-centred, rights-based support.
Many thanks. I now call on Annette Milne, up to 5 minutes, please, Dr Milne.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'd like to add my thanks to the Health and Sport Committee clerks, to the Bill team and the many witnesses and stakeholders who have been so helpful throughout the parliamentary process of this Bill. The 2003 Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act was a very important piece of legislation, which sought to minimise interference in people's liberty and maximise the involvement of people with mental health issues in their treatment, giving them the right to express their views about their care and treatment, the right to independent advocacy, the right to submit an advance statement about how they wish to be treated when they become ill, and the right to choose a named person to act on their behalf when necessary. 12 years on from this Act, and following the McManus Review in 2009, it became clear that some aspects of the 2003 Act are not working as well as intended, and the current bill aims to improve and bring additional clarity to that Act so that patients indeed benefit from the intended minimum interference and maximum involvement with their treatment. The principles of this amending bill were generally welcomed at stage one, but it was recognised that significant amendments would be needed to ensure that the policy intention became effective, and there were serious concerns in certain policy areas. Amendments at stages 2 and 3 have served to allay a number of the concerns expressed to the Health and Sport Committee by witnesses and stakeholders, but some remain unresolved. The Minister has made it very clear that he sees the current bill as a light-touch review of the 2003 legislation and doesn't intend to accept more fundamental changes without further detailed consultation and review. Among the amendments to be welcomed is the one which removes the initial proposal to extend the period of short-term detention from 5 to 10 days, an issue of concern raised by the Law Society. And the Mental Welfare Commission is pleased to see the limit of a suspension of detention kept at 200 days and not extended to 300 days as originally proposed. The tightening of the legislation to ensure that a named person is identified only when the patient wants one, the requirement for health boards to publicise the support offered by them to make or withdraw an advance statement and respond to requests about such support from the Mental Welfare Commission, the right of appeal for named persons in cases of cross-border transfer, and the steps taken to gather information about the provision of advocacy services so that these may become more readily available to people who wish to use them. These are all very welcome improvements to the bill as originally proposed. But, Presiding Officer, there are still remaining concerns, particularly, as we've heard a lot this afternoon, around people with learning disability and those on the autistic spectrum, who are currently included within mental health legislation because they have these lifelong conditions, whether or not they are also mentally ill. There are differences of opinion amongst experts as to whether this is right, but there is strong feeling amongst those affected that current mental health legislation is inappropriate and that disability should be defined as an intellectual impairment rather than a mental disorder. And a strong plea has been made for a wholesale review of mental health and incapacity legislation. Such a review was proposed by the Milan Committee as far back as 2001, and it was again recommended by McManus in 2009. So there is understandable frustration that this has not yet been achieved. The Minister's clear commitment to a comprehensive participative review of the inclusion of learning disability and autism in mental health legislation is very welcome, and I can understand why he doesn't want to commit to a timescale that might curb the scale of the review. Nevertheless, there is a degree of urgency about this, and I'm sorry that he didn't accept Jackie Bailey's Stage 3 amendment to make sure that this is done within 3 years. There are also...
Jamie Hepburn.
I understand where she's come from. I understand the frustrations that exist out there. That's one of the reasons that we've committed to undertaking this review. I think the point she spoke to there was the urgency, the necessity to get on with this task. And in that regard, I can, and as I've already pointed out, officials are already in dialogue with some stakeholders about this process. We're beginning this process already. I hope, again, that gives a signal of our intent here.
I do understand it, and I fully accept the intent, but I think we would really like to know the end of the process rather than that it has begun. There are also unresolved issues around the use of psychoactive substances, which the Minister again has agreed to consider during the promised review, and again, this is welcome. So to conclude, Presiding Officer, this amending legislation, which intends to clarify and improve the implementation of the 2003 Act in the interest of the patients affected by it, is timely and welcome. But I do expect more changes will be required after further review takes place. Significant advances have already been made in helping patients with mental health problems, but I think this is still work in progress, and continuing scrutiny of current legislation must be ongoing with an open mind regarding further changes as and when required. Presiding Officer, I've confined my remarks to some of the proposals in Part 1 of the Bill and have chosen not to elaborate on Parts 2 and 3 on criminal cases and victims' rights. I will merely add that the legislative changes proposed in Parts 2 and 3 are welcome and we are supportive of them. So all in all, we are comfortable with this amending legislation and we will be supporting it at decision time this evening. Thank you.
Many thanks. And we now move to open debate. And I call on Bob Dorris to be followed by Rhoda Grant. 4 minute speeches, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I welcome the Mental Health Scotland Bill as amended at both Stage 2 and Stage 3 of the process? And I very much hope and I believe it will be passed later on this evening. This bill is specific, it's focused, and it will deliver a number of significant, if and although in some ways incremental, ways to benefit the people of Scotland. And I'm pleased that this afternoon the Chamber agreed to my amendment to place a duty for health boards to publicise any support it may offer in the making and the withdrawing of advance statements, as well as being required to provide information to the Mental Welfare Commission in relation to meeting this duty. I very much hope that this will drive change to boost the awareness of, the numbers of, and the use of advance statements in ensuring the wishes of those with mental health disorders, their wishes in terms of treatment and their life are respected where they can be. I'm also pleased that in other areas we've extended rights, including, for example, the rights to victims of crime to have the extension of a victim notification scheme, and that is only correct and fitting that we do that. It's also been a listening process, this piece of legislation. I feel, as I've already mentioned, the Scottish Government listened to my case in relation to advance statements this afternoon at Stage 3, and indeed to other members, and they back some other amendments also, but also a number of amendments by a variety of members at Stage 2, and I'll perhaps mention just one of mine in relation to restricting the amount of invasive treatments that cross-border absconding patients could get in terms of emergency treatment should they arrive in Scotland, and the Government moved to protect the rights of those vulnerable, if at times challenging, individuals, and that was fit and appropriate that they do that. I want to say a little bit about learning disabilities in terms of this bill and this process being shaped by the whole Parliament. A government that listens is a government that will accept some, quite a lot, but not necessarily all amendments that come forward, and that's only right. There seems to be an undercurrent in relation to learning disabilities that if you don't accept all of the amendments, then somehow government is not listening in that area. And I would say that is simply not the case. In terms of learning disabilities, I'll obviously look forward to more information in relation to any review in terms of that. But any review that comes forward, I would like to make sure it's a rights-based approach we have to treating people with learning disabilities and those living with autism. And in relation to that, I hope we can give cognizance to how aspects such as the implementation of self-directed support by local authorities, particularly in the city of Glasgow, has negatively impacted on those with learning disabilities in the city I represent and the constituents that I represent. And I hope that can be reflected in terms of how we take this forward. In terms of service provision for those living with learning disabilities, there were some fine learning disability centres in Glasgow which were gateways for very vulnerable adults to engage and interact with the wider community. And many of them have been left without the required support, and their right to that facility was withdrawn by the local authority. So when we look at how we treat and we respect those living with learning disabilities, I think we have to look at the role of local authorities to make sure they meet their obligations to meet the rights of those living with learning disabilities. And certainly the people I represent in Glasgow feel that many of their rights have been withdrawn. But I look forward to supporting this bill this evening, and it will improve the lot of those living with mental health challenges in Scotland going forwards.
Excellent. Many thanks. Now Colin Rhoda-Grant to be followed by Jim Hume.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This bill is welcome, and the changes it makes in the law will make a positive difference to the lives of individuals. However, it's clear that much more needs to be done. We need to give mental health the same focus and consideration as physical health, and there's still a huge amount of misunderstanding and stigma surrounding mental health, and we, through the laws we make, need to tackle this. I, like others, was disappointed that Jackie Bailey's amendment was voted down today. It was clear during the passing of the bill that mental health legislation covers people that are not mentally ill, people with learning difficulties and other conditions such as autism. They do need additional support. However, their condition is not a mental illness, albeit at times they're predisposed to mental illness due to their isolation from wider society. We need laws that not only support and protect them, but go further to integrate them into society. Or maybe I should say we need laws that change societal attitudes and structures so that they don't face the barriers and attitudes that prevent them from playing their full part. When I was speaking to constituents about the bill, they told me about the lack of services available for people who have personality disorders. They do not receive crisis mental health support and are often left for the police to deal with. It's sad that one constituent said to me that this wasn't necessarily such a bad thing, given the police often showed more compassion than those providing mental health services. While acknowledging the compassion the police exercise when dealing with vulnerable people, they shouldn't be the only help available to people with personality disorders who become psychotic. There must be a better way of providing them with emergency mental health support through the health service. There's also a lack of support for carers, especially when the cared for person comes out of hospital. We all know that this transition is a time of the greatest risk of suicide. However, carers are often left ignorant of that risk and how they can best support their loved ones. This is not right, and they should have the information and the support they need to help recovery, especially during those very early stages where the risk is greatest. This is also an issue raised with me recently with carers of people who had suffered brain injury. Again, I reiterate, mental health services deal with illness rather than injury and disabilities. And carers are left to care for their loved ones, not knowing how the condition will progress, improve, and what, if anything, they can do to enhance recovery. Surely there must be a better way of supporting people in that situation. We need to reassess what's covered by our mental health services and where the gaps are with regard to disabilities and indeed brain injuries as well. We need to make sure that services are available to all and are compassionate and caring. And I hope the government reviews the current legislation, renews it in order to make it fit for its intended purpose and to ensure that this emergency provision is available for all. I welcome the bill, but hope that we will deal with the issues of mental health impairments and brain injuries before too long a time has elapsed. Carers and patients can't afford to wait much longer.
Thanks very much. I now call on Jim Hume to be followed by Mark MacDonald.
Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm pleased to see the Mental Health Bill at this very final stage. I'm hopeful of the positive changes which the bill will bring to the Mental Health Scotland Act 2005, which, as I noted earlier, must have the aim of always protecting the vulnerable, while of course extending their rights. But I, like others, believe if it had been amended today in certain areas, the bill would have been so much better. But throughout the course of this bill, we've seen concerns that the patients haven't been the focus of the bill. We saw concerns that the rights are compromised for sake of administrative ease, that issues of patient privacy weren't being taken as seriously as they should, that mental health officers and staff were being expected to undertake and complete an overwhelming amount of tasks, all of which under, of course, overstretched resources and reduced workforce numbers. So I was pleased to see, however, as with other fellow MSPs were, that there was a wide outreach to a number of key stakeholders and organisations, such as the British Psychological Society, Inclusion Scotland, Autism Rights and, of course, SAMH, among many, many others, all helping, I think, to improve key components of this bill. So we're grateful very much to all those organisations. I was pleased to see that a number of amendments to this bill sought to address some shortfalls, such as, of course, Dr Simpson's amendment on psychotropic substances, the Minister's move to safeguard patients' rights by extending notification of detention to a patient's guardian or welfare attorney, and, of course, Jackie Bailey's urging of the Minister to review the meaning of mental disorder within a specified amount of time. So I was disappointed, of course, that that amendment was not supported. I believe that through successfully amending this piece of legislation, we would have created a stronger bill which would have addressed a number of these shortfalls. However, and therefore, so much hard work still lies ahead, and that includes addressing the rights of those with learning disabilities. While the bill aimed to help people with a mental disorder access effective treatment quickly and efficiently, I'm still concerned about the state of our mental health system in Scotland. We can legislate and we can try to protect the vulnerable and ensure that everyone's rights are protected, but we can't ignore the condition that the current mental health system is in. Services are severely underfunded, staff's overworked, and all of this against a background of growing numbers of people from all ages coming forward and asking for help and support. But most importantly, Deputy Presiding Officer, and this is a provision lacking from the wider legislative framework in Scotland, is the fact that mental health is not yet enshrined in law as being equally important as physical health. So I'm pleased that steps are taken by this Parliament. Just a second, and I shall. I'm pleased that steps are taken by this Parliament to address mental health, but I remain worried about how much longer we will have to wait until we see serious action taken to close the disparity. Thank you.
Jimmy Hepburn.
Yes, the member, again, I praise the member for his consistency of raising this issue. I will not rehearse again the fact that it was already the case there is equality in law, but he suggests there was the need to legislate, and here we have had a legislative vehicle, we've had a mental health bill. I'm not aware of Mr Hume having brought forward an amendment to that effect.
We did look into that, and we realised that this bill was so structured that you couldn't change it to put the parity in. So we know that mental health is not just an issue that affects a small, invisible group of people. It will affect one in four Scots at some point through their lives. We're also seeing children and adolescents being admitted to hospitals in growing numbers due to self-harm and eating disorders, people at work taking more and more days off with underlying causes such as depression and anxiety, while our society continues to attach a stigma to these conditions. Deputy Presiding Officer, I'll finish by saying I'm hopeful that we're taking the right steps today in helping our fellow citizens get better access to treatment while ensuring their rights are protected. I hope to see further action taken forward in law and in practice so that we can create a mental health system in Scotland that sets the standard to be followed and is fit for the future. And we shall be, of course, supporting the bill at decision time today. Thank you.
Many thanks. I now call on Mark MacDonald to be followed by Malcolm Chisholm. 4 minutes or thereby, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And this, I think, is a very important piece of legislation. It's a piece of legislation which is very close to me personally for a number of reasons. I have experience of close family members who have gone through periods of mental ill health and some who are continuing to go through periods of mental ill health. So the issue is one which I have a very strong interest in. Aside from that, there's also the issue around the learning disability autistic spectrum disorder matter, and I'll perhaps touch on that first. There's often a feeling that in politics we seek to invent division where division does not exist. The reason for the amendment being rejected, I accept that, you know, the intention behind the amendment from Jackie Bailey and what it sought to do was broadly supported. Indeed, it was supported by these benches as well. It's why the Minister has committed repeatedly to undertaking the review. The reason why it was rejected from my perspective was that I felt that there were technical elements of it which I felt might have constrained the process at a later stage. I think one of the things which perhaps would be helpful, and I'm interested to know if the Minister might be open to this, is perhaps an early stakeholder event which could be wide-ranging and could look at, for example, terms of reference for the review and other matters to be considered. It might be an opportunity, I think, as an article of good faith for those on different sides of the chamber who have expressed some doubt as to the commitment of the Scottish Government. That might be a helpful approach to take, and I wonder if the Minister might perhaps deal with that in his closing remarks. I think in terms of the comments made by Jim Hume, I think one of the other difficulties that we often face in politics is that we overstate, I think, the situation as affects sections of society, sections of our health service. There is no doubt that there are pressures faced by mental health services, there are pressures faced by all of our health services. It is the nature of the health service that it will find itself facing pressures because it is a demand-led service. People will seek out support and help as they require it. The difficulty I have is that if we look back to prior to the SNP government coming in to being, if we look at the situation as it was then, there has been remarkable improvement in terms of how mental health is dealt with in terms of both the funding that is allocated towards mental health services, in terms of the driving down of waiting times in terms of mental health services. I don't disagree for one second that there is more to be done. Indeed, the Minister himself has said on repeated occasion that there is more to be done in terms of mental health waiting times. But I think anybody who was to look at the situation as inherited and where we have got to now would be hard-pressed, I think, not to say that there has been progress made in these areas. That's not to say that there isn't more to be done. That's why I think it's welcome that the Minister has, on more than one occasion, announced funding allocations specifically to drive improvement in terms of mental health services. But, you know, funding isn't the only answer in all of this, Presiding Officer, and the funding to mental health services, while important, is focused often on dealing with problems as they have arisen. Now, we can't prevent all mental health conditions from arising because we know that the mental health can affect anybody in society at any time, but we can look at and see where in society do we see that there is perhaps more occurrences of certain mental health problems. Are they linked to perhaps some of the societal pressures that are being faced? In particular, Presiding Officer, one of the things that I would welcome the opportunity for us to look at, perhaps not in this Parliament, but perhaps elsewhere, is the pressures that are now facing our young people in society. Young people now face a great deal of pressures through their interactions with one another, through social media usage, and the impacts that that can have on young people's mental health, I think is something that merits further examination at some stage in the future. But I welcome this legislation, and I hope it receives unanimous support at decision time.
Many thanks. I now call Malcolm Chisholm, after which we move to closing
officer,
speeches.
I also welcome this bill. And as ever, at stage three, we have to decide whether the glass is half empty or half full, because on the one hand, we certainly welcome the fact that several amendments were put forward and accepted both at stage two and stage three. But on our side of the chamber, we're clearly disappointed that some good amendments were rejected by the government today. I mean, I should also say to the minister, I suppose it's quite a small glass compared to the original one. I note that he had 48 amendments to deal with today. At stage three in 2003, there were 756 amendments, and at stage two in 2003, there were 1,367. So I'll give way to that.
Yeah,
that this speaks to my collaborative and open approach at stage two.
Well, I think we were collaborative then as well. But the nature of the bill clearly was as an amendment bill, although there may well be a need for a wider review in due course, not only of the learning disability issue, which I hope will proceed without delay, but also, I think, in the longer run, in terms of how this Act interacts with the Adults with Incapacity Act, given their different and overlapping functions and their different definitions of incapacity. But anyway, in terms of progress, obviously all this is against the principles of the original bill in terms of reciprocity, least restrictive alternative, and so on. And it's the many of all the things we've discussed today relate to what was set up by that bill in terms of the Mental Health Tribunal, the named person, the advocacy rights, and so on. So in terms of progress, at stage two, yes, it's good that changes were made in terms of the extension of short-term detention from 5 to 10 days in the original bill being reversed, and also in terms of the proposal for a default named person being rejected at committee. Today, we've had progress on this suspension of detention, on two Richard Simpson amendments on statistical information and the review of deaths in detention, on advocacy, perhaps one of the most welcome advances today, and all credit to the Minister for that, and also Bob Doris's amendment about publicising support, health boards publicising support and making for people making advance statements. But we are disappointed that there isn't a stronger duty to promote advance statements. On this side, we're also disappointed about the limited progress on levels of security, but we won't rerun that debate at this time. And also, I think I'm very disappointed that there was no movement on psychologists. I think at one point that the minister, perhaps it was in committee, invoked the fact that that wasn't appropriate in an amending bill. But that was a very discreet change, which I think, particularly given the proposal was for that to be done in regulations, it was unfortunate that that opportunity was completely rejected by the minister today. Now, of course, there are other issues from the McManus review that perhaps haven't been taken up by the legislation. We welcome the fact that many of his recommendations were taken up. But the Equal Opportunities Committee report on McManus in 2010 is worth looking at, because they were focusing very much on the equality issues of this of McManus and the original legislation, and equality was one of the 10 Milan principles. And I think there are still concerns about equality groups in relation to this, for example, young people, and we know there's still an issue about young people in adult beds. And the other issue that McManus and the Equal Opportunities highlighted was the Section 25 to 31 duties of local authorities to promote the well-being and social development of all persons in the area who have or have had mental disorder. So again, that's something that's been out with the scope of this amendment bill, but I think we shouldn't forget these other aspects, these wider aspects of mental health as well. And if the last point I can make, just to remind us of that, and I welcome all the progress that's been made in mental health, but we've all seen the horrifying story on today's front pages from my own area about a postnatal depression tragedy that arose because the service wasn't available for the woman in question. So we know there's a lot to do, but we welcome the progress that has been made on mental health in general, and we welcome the progress that has been made in this bill today.
Thank you very much. And we now move to closing speeches, and I call on Mary Scanlon. 4 minutes, please, Mary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would also like to commend the members of the Health Committee for their sterling work on this mental health bill, and I give credit to all progress that's contained in the bill. And I do appreciate it's a step in the right direction, but I think that we would be failing in our duty to mental health if we didn't put on record just how much more there is to do. In terms of Jackie Bailey's amendment, she was asking for a review. I think it's reasonable that the Minister said that he would conduct the review. But I would also put on the record that we were promised the Sandra Grant review of mental health services in 2004. We thought that we were very reasonable, giving that review 10 years to be completed. And 2014 came and went, as they say, and we're still waiting for it. I know it's supposed to be coming later this year, but, you know, I do think the government needs a prod in the right direction. In preparing for this debate, I looked at my closing speech in March 2003 for the Mental Health Bill. It was a week before the dissolution of Parliament, and I spoke that it was with a sigh of relief rather than a sense of pride that I passed the bill, given the huge number of amendments. But what I did say at that time, and I think others said as well, the legislation would only be effective if health boards and local authorities gave it the priority it deserves. So on local authorities, I looked up the policy memorandum, and in paragraph 168, it states the Scottish Government does not consider that the measures in this bill have any disproportionate effect on local government. And it also states the role of mental health officers who will be affected in terms of the bill. Well, it would seem that the Scottish Government have not been listening to the many calls. I give credit to Jim Hume and many others in this chamber, highlighting the drastic shortage of mental health officers across Scotland and the increased workload this Parliament has imposed on them. At Highland Council last week, it was stated that mental health officer reports legally required under the Adults with Incapacity Act, legally required within 3 weeks, were taking 3 years. And just because this patient group is unlikely to complain, it's no good reason for not providing sufficient staff to ensure that the support is given. I do not disagree with the abolition of ring-fence funding for local authorities, but the Scottish Government should, at the very least, ensure that local authorities are fulfilling their statutory obligations in line with the bills that we've passed today and previous Acts of Parliament. It's worth looking at why mental health should be a priority. Up to 75% of people using illegal drugs have a mental health issue, Audit Scotland report. Up to 50% of people with alcohol problems have a mental health issue, often called self-medication. 7 in every 10 prisoners are identified as having mental health problems. 1 in every 3 visits to a GP is for a mental health issue. And about 9% of our population is on antidepressants. But given that this bill is looking at accessing of treatment, can I just say that the Milan principles, number one, people with mental disorder should, whenever possible, retain the same rights and entitlements as those with other health needs. It's there. It's there. So why, if they have the same entitlement as others, given the CAMHS target for 90% to be seen in 18 weeks, only 8 health boards meet this target? And in Tayside, only 35% of children are seen within 18 weeks, with an average median wait of 49 weeks. That's not good enough. In March of this year, 4,200 children waiting to start treatment in a CAM service. It's not good enough. And if that wasn't bad enough that 4,200 children are waiting, I was absolutely shocked to read that for psychological therapies, the waiting list is 17,530.
You must draw to a close.
17,530, up 1,500 since the Minister took office. So can I just say the government need to look at how positive mental health can influence physical health. We don't need more legislation. We simply mean a better understanding, more empathy, a better working together. It needn't cost more money.
Thanks so much. I now call on Dr. Richard Simpson. 6 minutes are there, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This bill was a modest one, but as Mark MacDonald and Jenny Marra have said, it was an important one. It was based on the McManus report, although, as Malcolm Chisholm reminded us, the level of amendments to the original 2003 bill were absolutely massive, whereas here it was fairly modest, thank goodness. But even then, not all the McManus proposals were included. I welcome the fact that the government has listened carefully to the evidence and the Stage 1 report and Stage 2 debates. And as a result, I'm able to welcome and commend them for recognising some of the concerns which led them to actually withdraw some of the original proposals, such as the 10-day proposed extension to tribunal hearings, the length of time to appeal against transfer, and today the withdrawal of the proposed extension of the community treatment order suspension period, which was proposed should be by a further 100 days. I also particularly welcome in this bill the victim notification scheme and some of the other measures in the Act, which will undoubtedly help the mental health and care and treatment of people in Scotland. I do regret the fact that the nurse's power to detain was not left as it was. I still don't understand where this came from or what the consultation was about it. Simply sort of tightening it up and making it simpler is fine. But the existing cases were not being reported to the Mental Welfare Commission in the first place, and I think that's what needs to be tightened rather than the rules or the 2 or 3 hour ability to detain. I regret also the fact that many of my amendments were rejected, and indeed, of course, that of Jackie Bailey and Annette Milne. They were made after careful consideration of the evidence presented and, of course, discussions and support that I received from a number of organisations. But notwithstanding the rejection, I hope many of them will be part of the wider review the government have, I understand now, already instructed civil servants to start thinking about. And I welcome that sense of urgency that I think the Minister is lending to this, and I hope that he will be able to continue to apply that pressure. The issue of learning disability or intellectual impairment and also autism spectrum disorder will need to be addressed. And Mark MacDonald called for a wider stakeholder conference to look at the remit of the review, and I hope that the Minister will consider that. I hope very much that actually this review will not be some sort of internal review leading to a bill, but will be a full-blown commission of the sort that Milan had. Because we do have a situation where Milan and McManus did recommend that all the acts, 95 Criminal Procedure Act, the 2000 Incapacity Act, the 2003 Mental Health and Care and Treatment Act, and the 2007 Protection of Vulnerable Adults Act, these acts must all actually be considered. And that is, as the Minister has said previously, quite a complex issue and will require a commission with some standing able to command broad support. But I think if we begin with the sort of conference Mark MacDonald was suggesting, then we may be able to at least have a remit that is appropriate. Because there are serious concerns about a range of issues. The right to refuse treatment, which is a fundamental right, and yet it is not applied to those with mental health, except under certain specific conditions, and not if they give an advance statement that was rejected today. The use of psychoactive medicines, which I believe is still far too widespread. I think that the fact that antidepressants were being used in increasing amounts was perhaps appropriate because GPs were learning to prescribe for longer periods of time and in appropriate dosages. But the amounts have gone on rising, and that really is becoming a matter of concern, although I know that particular target has been dropped. There is the vexed question of the difference in application between a seriously impaired decision-making ability under the 2003 Act and the definition of incapacity under the 2000 Act, and that needs to be addressed. There is the question of the use of physical restraint addressed for children, but I think it needs to be looked at again for adults, where I feel that it may be being inappropriately used in one or two situations. The numbers adversely affected by the issues which I've mentioned may be small, but even one is too many. And I do believe that the guardians of good care and treatment should have more powers. The Mental Welfare Commission, in its many and helpful reports, draws attention on too many occasions in which they have not been able to get the information they required. So the acceptance of Amendments 25, 35 and 36 will undoubtedly help. But I still believe that Scotland needs regulators with teeth. And unless we have that, then just having them for small sections like HEI or, in some occasions, by the Mental Welfare Commission is not enough. I think that HIS, the Care Inspectorate, the Mental Welfare Commission, we need to look at that again. We decided not to integrate them at the last reform, and I think that was correct at the time, but I think there are issues around there that may need to be looked at. I agree and disagree with Mark MacDonald on his comments on mental health. I agree there's been progress, for example, in care plans for severe and enduring mental illness. But on child and adolescent mental health, the admission to adult wards after some progress, which was welcomed by the Mental Health Commission, has gone back since 2009, as Malcolm Chisholm reminded us. Mary Scanlon listed a number of issues, including the number of MHOs, which have reduced the ability of local authorities to actually deal with mental health issues, and listed a number of other concerns, which I agree with, and particularly in relation to prisoners, where I think there is far more needs to be done. Rhoda Grant drew attention to the issue of personality disorders, which are still not being managed effectively in Scotland, but also to intellectual impairment associated with brain damage. I will conclude by thanking all those who gave evidence and the many organisations who helped me to formulate the amendments and agreements supporting the issues raised. I want to thank the Parliament legislative team, whose drafting and response to the changes I sought were always patient and often creative. And I think the debates have been invaluable only to inform the review. We've made great progress since 1999, but we need to keep moving forward, recognising the changes, particularly in neurodevelopmental science, but also in culture. We need to change things. Labour will, however, support the bill fully tonight.
Thank you, Dr. Simpson. Can I now call on Jamie Hepburn to wind up the debate? Minister, until 6:50, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and can I thank members for their contributions to this debate. I'll try and cover as much ground as I can, although this bill has a relatively narrow focus. Many of the provisions within it will make a real difference for service users. Jenny Mara said at the outset she was right to talk of the constituents who approach us about many issues related to mental health. I suppose it's always important to have them in mind as we take this work forward. This bill has at its heart the aim of protecting service users' rights and interests, ensuring the system under the 2003 Act works as effectively as possible. As I said before, I'm grateful to members and stakeholders for working with the government to get the provisions exactly right. I think it's been a collaborative process. We've been able to work with the committee very effectively to make sure the bill is as good as it possibly can be. This bill is only part of the government's wider programme to improve mental health services. Rhoda Grant is right to say that there's more that has to be done. She and other members can be assured that my focus will always be on that. But it is important, nonetheless, that those who need compulsory treatment under this Act are able to access treatment quickly and to have their rights and interests protected. And this bill will play a key part in assuring this. Jenny Mara raised some concerns about the bill's compatibility to ECHR. Let me say to her, I take very seriously the responsibility to have due regard to human rights. I think it's essential. From a human perspective, it is, of course, a legal requirement too. The bill is underpinned by a variety of processes of appeal and rights to express a view. I believe it is compatible with ECHR. I'm unaware of any ruling that says the Mental Health Act in this bill is not so compatible. Let me assure her I'll always listen to and respond to concerns that are seriously raised. A variety of members raised the issue of the review of the inclusion of learning disability and autistic spectrum disorder in the scope of the Mental Health Act. I recognise there has been a disappointment out there that the review hasn't taken place sooner. Let me be clear, President, because I made the commitment to that review in the stage one, in the government's response to the stage one report of the committee. I should make the point that was a commitment made in advance of stage two amendments. In advance of stage three amendments, it is a serious commitment. Work has tentatively begun to engage with stakeholders. Again, I hope that as an indication of our serious intent, Bob Doris asked whether this would be a rights-based approach in undertaking the review. He can be assured that I can absolutely commit to that being the process we will follow. Mark MacDonald and Dr. Simpson latching on to Mr. MacDonald's suggestion, I am absolutely open to a stakeholder event early on, as has been suggested, to help move this process forward, and I'll make sure that Scottish Government officials move forward on that basis. Let me say there is no disagreement across this chamber, I think, on the need for a review. Yes, the government was not able to support the amendment that was presented earlier. That's not because
of the principle, but because of some of the specific mechanisms, there was a hard timescale, which I do not think is necessarily helpful to ensuring that we have the fullest review possible. Moreover, and more substantially, there was provision on the face of that amendment for removing learning disabilities from the definition of mental health disorder by way of regulation, if that's what the review concluded had to be done. I'm not necessarily convinced that's the best way forward, in the sense that it would summarily remove all the protections and rights those with learning disability have under the Act without replacing them. I don't think that any of us would want to proceed on that basis. And I think the point that was made earlier about the need for proper scrutiny of any new measures that would potentially be brought forward is a valid one. I'm not convinced that could necessarily be as readily done by way of bringing forward regulations. Let me be clear, the review will be participative, and we have not yet determined how the review will exactly be conducted. We want to involve stakeholders in shaping it. I'm committed that the review will begin as soon as possible. I do not want to put an artificial timescale on its conclusion. The timescale that was set out in the amendment may be possible. Let me make my commitment. I want the review to be concluded as soon as possible. It is important that we do not curtail that review, especially in light of the fact that I have also committed to including in that review the issues around psychotropic substances, and also issues around the inclusion of psychologists within the scope of this particular piece of legislation. Jim Hume and Mary Scanlon made reference to the burdens we place as a parliament through our legislation on mental health officers. I recognise a very clearly invaluable contribution made by mental health officers to improving the lives of mental health patients and their friends and families. I said earlier this government has announced an additional £85 million investment over the next 5 years, taking our total additional investment announced in May and November of last year in mental health services to £100 million. The Scottish Government has also undertaken a scoping exercise to gather evidence around the capacity of the mental health officer workforce. This includes data provided in Mental Welfare Commission reports and in the Scottish Social Services Council's most recent workforce data report on mental health officers in Scotland. We'll be considering the draft report of that work in due course. Of course.
Mrs Scanlon.
Thank you. I appreciate you giving way. I did give the example of the Adults with Incapacity Bill, where Highland Council should statutorily provide a report by a mental health officer in 3 weeks, and they can't do it in 3 years. So can I ask about giving the £150 million, I think you said, how does that impact on workforce planning? Does that mean, you know, are there more mental health officers coming through the system?
Well, Minister? I think it's important to clarify it's £100 million, and not £150 million. It's still a substantial sum of money, I'm sure Mary Scanlon will agree. There are a range of ways that can be used to improve systems on the ground, and it could potentially be utilised in this area, I suppose. Let me turn to the issue that was raised by Malcolm Chisholm, presiding officer, around the issue of advance statements and the need for further promotion. The Mental Health Commission is currently taking forward a project to promote advance statements, and indeed the amendment proposed by Bob Doris will complement this work. As I said to Mr Chisholm earlier at the amendment stage, I have also suggested that the Code of Practice Working Group could look further to see if the guidance they have could help promote the use of advance statements. I think it's essential that we see advance statements used on a wider basis, and I'm serious about us working to that end. President Officer, I've heard general support for this bill across the chamber, and I think that's very welcome. I've heard some disappointment that some amendments have not been accepted. I should say I understand that. I think they've all been made earnestly, but I felt that they were not necessarily an effective way forward. But I also recognise, as Mary Scanlon said, beyond this bill there is more to do. This bill is only part of that work. I commend the bill to this chamber, but members can also be assured, President Officer, of my commitment to doing everything this Scottish Government can do to ensure a better sense of mental wellbeing right across Scotland, and I commend this bill to the chamber.
Thank you. That ends the debate on the Mental Health Scotland Bill. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 13608 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 13608. No member is asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the chamber. The question is that motion number 13608 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 13607 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a stage 2 timetable for the Harbour Scotland Bill. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 13607.
Moved.
No members asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the chamber. The question is that motion number 13607 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. The next item of business is consideration of a Parliamentary Bureau motion. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 13609 on the designation of a lead committee.
Moved.
And the question on this motion will be put at decision time. I am minded to accept a motion without notice to bring forward decision time to now. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move this motion.
Moved.
The question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. There are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is at motion number 13599, in the name of Jamie Hepburn, on the Mental Health Scotland Bill be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed, and the Mental Health Scotland Bill is therefore passed. The next question is at motion number 13609, in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick, on the designation of a lead committee be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time. We now move to members' business. Members who leave the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.